Einstein's son of a tomorrow. Now he will try for a new world record.
One.
Welcome back to day two of the International Athletes Forum 2021. Yesterday was an eye-opening and pretty informative day. So much to take in, so much to digest. So I hope you had some time to do just that.
Today, я надеюсь, will be no что different. У вас была
we
масса,
continue to dive into the issues that matter для, to you. The athletes surrounding the biggest platform in the world, the Olympic Games.
So,
for those of you tuning in for the first time today, I'm Jeanette Kwachi. I'm delighted to be your moderator as we come together for the first time digitally for the International Athletes Forum. Some housekeeping for you, because this is very different to what we're used to, this whole studio setup. We're delighted to say the forum is being live translated into French, Spanish, Russian, Chinese, and Arabic. To access one of these languages, click on the interpretation icon at the bottom of your screen, and that will sort you right out. Please put your camera on. I want to see your face. I saw so many of your lovely faces yesterday. It was a joy. Turn your camera on. And if you need any IT help during the session, please email athletesforum@olympic.org. The guys there will get you right back on track if you have any technical problems. For today, if you have questions for our panelists, then please use the raise hand icon so we can unmute your microphone and let you take the floor. You will join me in this studio right here. Or you can send an email or send a message through our social channels at athlete365. We'll also be using Menti to collect your questions for anything on the Olympic Games. Please do not forget to put your name and your location. Or if you have a question for the IOC president later, put it through Menti. Grab your phone, enter the code 17699654 and fire away. If you haven't seen, the virtual marketplace is open. It's brilliant. Make sure you go there and explore all of the booths. Some fabulous content from WADA, the International Testing Agency, Tokyo 2020, Paris 2024, and many, many, many more. As a treat, there's a $25 Airbnb Olympian experience voucher. It's up for grabs, so make sure you go to the Airbnb booth to claim it. We've made this so easy for you. We want you to network with everybody and send them messages. We're all here. Go to the attendees page and search for Athletes Commission's representatives that you want to speak to. Remember, we're here to share, We're here to collaborate, and we're here to really embrace our Olympic community, because it's a really, really big year for all of us. And today is a big, big day for the athlete community as we dive into these sessions. So to kick it off, who else? Kirsty Coventry, your IOC Athletes Commission Chair.
Hey, everybody, and welcome to day two. It's so great to see all of your faces on the screen. Here is a quick recap from yesterday. We had updates from our Vice Chair, Danka Bartikova, on the work of the IOC Athlete Commission and everything that they've done and we've done over the last 2 years. A quick shout out to Danka. We are missing you here today. Good luck at your competition, along with all your fellow shooters on your journey to Tokyo. We heard a presentation from Lana and James on athlete support, where we had a lot of great questions from many of you. We didn't get a chance to get to all of them, but please resubmit your questions on Menti with your name so that we can get back to you with the answers. We then jumped into athlete well-being, and it's always a key topic. And we had a great panel discussion with athletes and athlete representatives that are blazing the way with some incredible projects and mental health and safeguarding. And we heard directly from you on how potentially it would be more beneficial for athletes to speak to their peers as a first step. And because of that, we want to develop a workshop that will be handed over to the Athletes Commission so that you can support your athletes who may be going through these tough times. So we already have our first recommendation from yesterday that we'll continue working on for you. If you guys missed any of these sessions live, then I encourage you to watch them back on Athlete 365. But before we get started, I just wanted to let you know that in Tokyo this summer, we will have 4 new members joining the IOC AC. As always, at every Summer Games, 4 athletes from 4 different sports will be elected by athletes competing at the Games, which is always so exciting. The election will take place in the Olympic Village, and athletes can vote at Athlete 365 space at the entrance to the dining hall. We encourage all athletes at the Games to go and vote for your favorite candidates. You can find out more about all of the candidates on Athlete 365. Looking ahead to Beijing, there will be another 2 new members joining the AC as well. And the nomination process for candidates is open now. So if any of the winter athletes out there are interested in joining the IOC Athlete Commission, get in touch with your NOC to submit your candidature. The deadline is 13th of May, so get involved. Okay, so today we have another packed agenda. First up, we will hear all the news directly from Tokyo. Then I'll share with you some more details on Olympic Agenda 2020+5 with a focus on the athlete recommendations. And to wrap up the day, we will have a live Q&A with the IOC President, Thomas Bach. So get your questions ready and take this opportunity to ask anything. Here's a quick video.
Thank you so much, Kirsty, for the update. And of course, we're looking ahead to what's going to be a packed session. So let's kick it off, shall we? It's been an incredible 12 months that saw the start of a global pandemic. the first postponement of an Olympic Games. And only now are we coming out at the other end. The Olympic torch is lighting that tunnel. We must remain true to the values of sport and remember that sport and the Olympic Games have the potential and the power to change lives for the better on a daily basis. So we will now hear from Japan, and I'm pleased to introduce to you the seven-time Olympian and Tokyo 2020 president, Seiko Hashimoto.
インターナショナルアスリートフォーラムにご出席の世界中のアスリートの皆様、東京2020組織委員会会長の橋本聖子でございます。コロナ禍で史上初の延期となった東京2020大会ですが、開幕まであと2ヶ月を切りました。当初は多くの試合がなくなり、トレーニングもままならないような状態が続いていたと思います。皆様、本当に大変なご苦労をされて、この1年を乗り越えられてこられたと思います。昨年の今頃に比べれば、私たちはこの感染症のことをはるかによく理解できるようになりました。夏頃からは国内外で多くのスポーツが再開し、これまで430もの国際大会が開かれ、延べ5万4000人ものアスリートが大会に参加してきたと伺っています。日本にも皆さんの活躍の様子が伝わってまいりました。アスリートが躍動する姿は、生活を取り戻す象徴そのものだと実感しています。東京2020大会の開催について、ご心配の方もいらっしゃるかもしれませんが、私の会長としてのミッションは、皆様が迷いなく誇りを持って東京大会にご参加いただけるよう、コロナ対策に万全を期して準備に努めることです。今月、海外からもアスリートの皆さんを招いて開催されたテストイベントは問題なく実施することができました。これらの経験を経て、組織委員会は東京都、政府と緊密に連携しながら、安全で安心な大会開催のための最終段階に入っています。皆さんにとっても、そして皆さんをお迎えする国民にとっても、安全で安心な大会とするため、皆様に遵守いただきたいルールを記載したプレイブックを作成しています。最終版の公表は6月を予定しております。アスリートの皆さん、お一人お一人に大会成功に貢献する気持ちで、このルールを守って行動いただくよう、ぜひともお願い申し上げます。一つお知らせですが、来週6月3日にビクトリーセレモニーのお披露目をいたします。世界の皆さんにライブ配信をいたしますので、ぜひご覧になってください。表彰台に自らが立つ姿を思い浮かべていただいて、東京2020大会への思いを一層膨らませていただきたいと思います。それでは皆さん、7月に東京でお会いしましょう。お待ちしております。私たちも準備のラストスパートにしっかりと尽力してまいります。ありがとうございました。それではローザンヌにお戻しをいたします。
Thank you very much, Seiko. A great message from Tokyo. Very exciting and creative, and better still, encouraging. I'd now like to introduce you to Mikako Kotani, Sports Director of Tokyo 2020, who is live in Tokyo. Hello!
Hello, Janet. Thank you for this opportunity. I'm Mikako Kotani, Sports Director of Tokyo 2020, and also an Olympian of artistic swimming. We are so much looking forward to welcoming you all to Tokyo for the Tokyo 2020 Olympic Games, which will happen in 57 days, so soon. We are all ready, all the preparation is going well, and Sumeiti and Mirai Towa are waiting for you, and all the countermeasure is all set, all the venues are ready and waiting for your great performances. So good luck to all of you with your training, and I'll see you very soon in Tokyo for the historical games.
Fabulous.
Thank you. And let's enjoy the rest of the forum.
Thank you so much. Oh, that's really exciting. And we love the mascots are also there. So massive thank you to Mikako. It was great having you live from Japan. This is really good. This is super encouraging that this games that we've had to postpone is on the right track. And I'm going to hand over to Kirsty now, who's got quite an exciting announcement for you as well.
Thank you, Jeanette. Just quickly, I think I previously had made the announcement that the deadlines for the Winter Olympians for our two candidates was the 13th of May. We've gone past that. It's the 13th of September. So just to bring some clarity, sorry about that, guys. Right, let's jump into this. Guys, we all know that COVID has shown us how to fully embrace technology. And who better to do that than our own broadcasting team, OBS. They have created a suite of fan engagement and athlete engagement solutions for Tokyo 2020. Firstly, for fan engagement, some new applications have been created which will allow international fans to show their support and put themselves virtually into the venues. And this is going to create a unique atmosphere of excitement and solidarity for the athletes in the venues. Then, for the athletes, we have a new initiative called Athlete Moment. I know as an Olympian how important the support of your family and friends is. So, the Athlete Moment has been created for the athletes and their families and friends to share their precious moments at the Olympic Games. Let me share with you how it's going to work. After an athlete competes, they will be able to connect remotely with family and friends chosen by the athlete and share the moment together through a normal computer, smartphone, or tablet. This is another great example of how, despite the challenges of COVID and the situation we are all facing today, we have become creative and presented new opportunities for fans, friends, and family to join in on the action. Let's take a short look at a short video.
This is your moment. We know your closest friends and family can't be with you in Tokyo, but we've developed a way for you to celebrate your most precious Olympic moments and your once-in-a-lifetime experiences. Right after your final competition ends, you'll be able to see and virtually hug your loved ones in real time. All athletes from the selected competitions will receive a personal and private web link to share with and invite up to 5 individuals or small groups to virtually join you in Tokyo. This link will allow your guests to join your personal athlete moment room and be ready by the time you have finished your competition. It's important you don't share this link with anyone other than your 5 nearest and dearest. Otherwise, the whole world will want to drop in to say hello. Here's how it works. Once the details and times of your final competition have been finalized, your selected group can arrange to join your private room around a half hour before your competition ends. They can talk to each other and all watch you compete and be there waiting for you at the finish. When you finish your competition, you head to the athlete staging station right before the mixed zone to share your moment with your friends and family. These moments will be distributed globally for use on TV and web. The whole experience lasts for a little over a minute, but the memories will last for a lifetime. Enjoy the moment.
What an incredible announcement there. One incredible announcement there from Kirsty. I mean, 5 athletes, 5 individuals even, in one room. How are you going to pick your 5 people? It's going to be tough, but during these times, it is so important to be as supportive as possible. So that's great news from OBS. Okay, should we speak to someone that's already qualified for Tokyo? Well, I'm delighted to be joined by Australian canoeist Jessica Fox. Hi, Jess, how are you?
Hi. Hi, everyone. Thanks for having me on tonight.
Brilliant stuff.
Well, today for you.
Yeah, well, but tonight for you, you're all the way out in Australia. What's the time where you are?
It's 10:20 p.m. currently.
I'm just glad that you stayed up for us. Thank you so much. And how's preparation going ahead of Tokyo, Jess?
Yeah, look, thanks. I think it's a great opportunity to be able to be here and share it. And I've actually come from an Olympic team function as we're getting ready to head overseas now. So it's all becoming very real. And I think this last, 12 months has been really challenging for athletes all over the world. We've all sort of had to adapt and had our preparations disrupted in some way. I mean, I never would have thought that my backyard swimming pool would be part of my Olympic preparation when I would chuck a kayak in there at some point during the lockdown. So I think the important thing has always been about detaching myself from the idea of an ideal preparation and really being set on one thing and being able to be fluid and adaptable. So, we've had to make the most of the restrictions here and not being able to travel overseas for competitions. I'm really looking forward to finally getting over there. And I have full confidence, I think, even just hearing the updates just then from Tokyo, live from Tokyo, I think there's been great communication from the IOC and I have full confidence in TOCOG and the Japanese and the IOC to put on a safe game. So I just, can't wait to get over there. It's starting to feel real and 57 days to go.
Yeah, 57 days, but nobody's counting over here. What I will say, though, Jess, what's brilliant about the updates that we've just heard are some of the things that friends and family will be able to do with athletes immediately after competition. That must come as a relief that you might be able to connect so quickly with friends and fam after you finish.
Yeah, I love that news. I love that idea. I think it is really challenging for a lot of athletes to think that they won't have their support network there ready to cheer them on and just to share those moments. So anything we can do to bring them to us, to connect with them will be really special. I'm lucky my mum is my coach, so she'll be with me, but I'm really excited to be able to connect with my dad and my sister and my grandparents in Europe as well. So I think that's a wonderful initiative and idea, and keen to see how that goes and whatever other initiatives come up and other ways we can communicate and bring people to the Olympic Games as well. And I hope that for those watching at home, we'll be able to bring a little bit of joy into people's living rooms.
Oh, brilliant stuff. Jess, it's so good catching up with you. I tell you what, we'll see you out there in Tokyo. The very, very best of luck. Thank you for coming on.
Thank you. Arigato. Bye, everyone.
Well, it's time for you to get your questions in, okay? Remember, this forum is all about you. And don't forget, we have Zoom, which is why I'm always asking you to have your cameras on so I can see your face. Just raise your hand and let me know that you want to come and join us here right on the floor. And don't forget, we also have menti.com with the code 1769-9654, or just scan the QR code and you're straight in. Please do not forget to put your name down with your question. So get those questions in for us. So as you heard there from Jess, 57 days to go. It's not far at all. In fact, it's going to come so, so quickly, which is why this forum is so important to make sure we get those final questions across to our experts here at the IOC. So we have four fantastic panelists here to answer all the questions you have about the Olympic Games. It's a pleasure to be joined by Kit McConnell, former head of the Rugby World Cup and now sports director here at the IOC. I'd like to welcome back Kirsty Coventry, your IOC Athletes Commission Chair, and James McLeod, Director of Olympic Solidarity and NOC Relations right here at the IOC, who's also with us yesterday for the Athlete Support Panel. And finally, we're joined by the Olympic Games Director himself, Pierre Ducret, joining us live from Tokyo today. He's the man with all the answers. So I'm going to get all my people to come up on the stage for me, please, if you don't mind. So I'm looking for Pierre. I don't see him up on my screen as of yet. So Kit, I'm going to start with you, okay? Oh, no, there's Pierre. Look at that. As if by magic, he just pops up. Pierre, how are you doing? Can you hear us and see us all okay?
I can hear you perfectly, yes.
Fantastic stuff. And Pierre, how is it going on the ground over there in Tokyo?
It's going very well, Janet. I think, you know, we've been here for a while already. I was hearing from Jess earlier that athletes are preparing hard, and we're doing exactly the same. We are athletes in our own way. That's how we like to look at it. We want to relate to the hard work they are putting in, and we are doing exactly the same here, working very closely with the organizing committee, of course, the city of Tokyo, the organizers in the government, also very closely with Kirsty, the Athletes Commission, because we very much see that as a joint work, that we understand what is really critical to the athletes and that we can then input that into the different documents we have been producing, and you've mentioned them. So as President Hashimoto, we are trying really to take into account the environment we have and create the best possible experience for everybody.
Fantastic stuff. That sounds really encouraging. Really, really good to hear you on the ground there, Kit. And just listening to having what Pierre said from a sports perspective, how are things going for you in the preparations for Tokyo?
Yeah, going well, and we're getting close. And firstly, hey, Pierre, good to see you and the team. I think we see each other many hours a day through video screens at the moment. So good to see you again. I hope the day's been good. Firstly, let me thank the athletes themselves. As you said at the start, Janet, it's been an incredible, unique, challenging journey over the last 15 months for many of the athletes, both personally, individually, but equally as I've looked forward to Tokyo last year, then adapting to international calendar changes, finding ways to train, then compete in international competitions, and now on the final lap towards Tokyo, as we heard from Jess so brilliantly just before. So we're getting close, 57 days, as you said. Tomorrow is 8 weeks, yeah. 8 Fridays, if you want to take it another way, and just 33 days before qualification ends as well. So we've got over 10,000 athletes that have qualified directly or through rankings at the moment. So things are getting very, very close. And from the Federation perspective, look, we're building on a lot of experience now. Every single one of the 33 sports on the program for Tokyo has returned to international competition, adapting to a COVID environment, delivering safe competitions, and building experience themselves in delivering their sports in this environment. Equally, we've had over 42,000 athletes that have competed in those events. So, you know, when we've got 47,000 athletes on the long list for Tokyo, that'll go down to 11,000 over the coming weeks. Most of those athletes have now competed internationally in this COVID-adapted environment in their respective sports. So building on the playbooks we have in place, taking that experience from the international federations, delivering these safe events, using the experience of the athletes themselves. You know, we're in a confident position, but we're not complacent. There's still a lot of final planning to be done as we go into that final push, but we're doing it with a really great base of planning in place in Tokyo and using the experience of the federations and of those athletes. And as Pierre said, you know, we're really keeping that focus on the athletes, 11,090 athletes. Many of them will be Olympians for the very first time and maybe for the only time in their career. So we need to make it absolutely special that we're giving them that Olympic stage to perform on. And if I could, Janet, just at the start, I'd also like to thank Kirsty, because, you know, Kirsty's not only the IOC Athletes Commission chair, but she's equally the co-chair of the NOCN Athlete Working Group for the Coordination Commission. So every time we're talking about athletes, it's Kirsty at the table, banging the table, as we heard yesterday, not only here in Lausanne, but in Tokyo as well. But the athlete voice has been at the center of every step of the planning and will remain so for the final 8 Fridays.
And you say 8 Fridays, Kit, and it gives me goosebumps, yeah, and my stomach just starts to go, because we know just how important that is. And when you put it like that, it's like, okay, next it will be 7 Fridays, then 6, and then before you know it, we are in Tokyo. Yeah. And this time, Kirsty, actually, this last 12 months or so during the postponement, it's really given the Olympic community time to think. And there, you mentioned briefly, there have been some changes to the Olympic oath. And I would love for you to be able to go through and just share with the Olympic community what that looks like.
Thanks, Jeanette. And thank you, Kit. Thanks for making me nervous. and thanks for making me blush. That was some nice comments. No, thank you, Jeanette, for the time. And guys, thank all of you, first of all, for all of your great feedback overall and with our consultation over the last 11, 12 months. And we wanted to share with you the Olympic Oath. I know some of you have seen it, but we wanted to take this opportunity because so many of you are online and joining us. And this is the first time that it's going to be read in the new way is in Tokyo. And we felt that it was really important to share with you all the really strong messaging that we have coming through in the new wording of the oath, when we talk about inclusion and equality and standing together in solidarity without any form of discrimination. You know, those are really key words that all of you gave to us and wanted us to implement and include into different areas of the Olympic Games. And this is one very strong recommendation that came from all of those consultations. And as we all know, the sport does make the world a better place. And we're just following that through with the Olympic Oath and excited to be a part of it. And again, thank you to all of you for those very strong recommendations. Very proud to be taking this through.
And that's testament, isn't it, to the IOC working alongside the athletes to make sure things are moving in the right direction. So yeah, please do make sure you check that out, take a look at that, because that is something that is part of the Olympic movement, you know, is going to be around for some time for sure. Okay, so you've been sending in your questions via Zoom and via Menti. So I'm going to kick off with a question that's come through on Menti first. And it says, what are the final stages of preparations for the Olympic Games? I would like to hear what actions are taking place at the moment. So Pierre, I might direct that towards you because you're right there, you're in the thick of it, where it's really starting to come together. So what does a day look like for Pierre at the moment?
Well, obviously, the days are very busy. I don't think anybody would expect something else. We are running through the last steps of the preparation. So at this moment, it is about making sure the finishing touches are put on the venues. We run a number of test events recently that you may have seen and heard about. The Diving World Cup recently with international participation, which gives us an opportunity to test some of the protocols that we have to make sure that we have everything, be it from a regular event standpoint, the venues, the overlay, all the services in place, but also the additional complexity of taking into account the new COVID countermeasures. So we are running through a lot of exercises. Earlier this week, for example, we took the organizing committee through 30 hours of a very complicated scenario trying with them. We were trying to look at different events that can happen during the games and see how they respond. So we created many issues for them, but for a good purpose, trying to make sure that they understand the kind of event that can take place and that we are completely ready. So this is really important to us right now, that we take all of the time necessary to train the people, the volunteers, that everybody know exactly what is supposed to do when the time comes to actually go into action. And this is a big focus right now for the organizing committee, for us, all the participants, because I know we're developing all
of the strategy. I think we'll check Pierre's line for the moment. We'll give Pierre some time. It's going a bit funny coming down from Japan there. But just listening to that, James, when Pierre's talking about scenarios and permutations, all the different things that can happen, how are NOCs and everybody else collaborating with that and trying to make sure that there is a nice consensus here that everyone's happy with?
Well, absolutely. I mean, everyone is working in the same direction at the moment. And it's called operational readiness. It's making sure that all the different components of the games, whether it's the organizing committee, the international federations, the national Olympic committees, are ready. And that is what every NOC will be focusing on now. Every athlete is focusing on that in the same way, because they want to make sure that every stone is left unturned or turned. I can't remember whichever one it is.
Stone.
There we go, Cassie. Thank you. To make sure that when they arrive at the starting line, all of the risks, all of the doubts that they had were put aside. And when you're in an organizing committee, that is extremely important. And operational readiness is, there's a big program that's in place where the different functional areas come together on tabletop exercises and look at what a scenario would be if there is a problem, if there's a problem in transport or et cetera. Now, obviously, on top of that, we've got all of the COVID countermeasures. Yeah. How do those work? You know, everyone's a bit unsure of how that will work. We talked about the testing regimes and you know, what happens when a test comes back positive. What do we do? So all of that is being looked at now in very granular detail. Mm-hmm. And that's at the organizing committee stage. But at the NOC and IF stage, the same thing, because they need to be ready as well. If a referee is ill, if an athlete, if they get lost in town, et cetera, et cetera. And Jess was referring to a team meeting for the Australian Olympic Committee. Well, that would be one of the stages in that preparation where they get everyone together and they say, this is what we're going to do as a team.
Fantastic. I can see Pierre's back, but we'll come back to you in a second, Pierre, because we've got some questions that have come in from our athlete community, Olympic community here on Zoom. So hello. Always that initial confusion. Can you hear us?
Hi, yes. Hello.
Hello. Hi. What's your name and where are you dialing in from?
Hey, I'm Tamás Tóth from Hungary, and I'm the chair at the World Triathlon Athletes Committee.
Brilliant, Thomas. What's your question and who is it for?
Well, mine is not really a question. I would like to share a news with you. You know,
Ahead. We love good news.
Nowadays, bad news are spreading so much faster than the good news. So I'm here to share with you some good news that we already delivered 2 weeks ago. We delivered our first bubble and successfully delivered our first bubble system in Yokohama, which was our first Olympic qualification race this year. And we had over 117 elite athletes competed there. And I would like to just ensure all of my fellow Olympians who are preparing for Tokyo that the service from the LOC, from the host nation, from the moment that we arrived to the airport, guided us to the hotels and all of the professionality in the training venues were so amazing that I'm super confident how they're going to do it in Tokyo, and I'm looking forward and as always the Japanese perfection was there, and I'm really looking forward for the Olympic Games, and I would like to say a big thank you for the Japanese and for the World Triathlon staff who made this happen, and see you all soon in Tokyo.
Thank you so much, Thomas. Well done. That's really good news. It's encouraging, isn't it? It's really, really encouraging. And I guess, Kit, when you hear things like that and you hear success stories like that, it's such a fast moving situation that you think, right, that's good, that's happened that time, but there may be another time where it may not go as well, right?
Yeah, firstly, Tomas, great to hear from you and see you. I still remember when you came in and signed our Olympic wall at the office. And great to see you and hear the positive feedback regarding the event in Yokohama. But yeah, I think as James and Pierre were saying, we're in delivery mode now. You know, we're that close to the games. We've got the key building blocks in place. We're really looking at the fine tuning and how we bring the different elements together. That IF sport-specific experience, the athlete experience, building on the playbooks that the Japanese authorities, the government, the organizing committee have put in place, and how those all fit together. And let's not forget that we're dealing with two things that have come up. One, the first ever postponed Olympic Games in history. That in itself has been quite a journey. Then we've got the COVID countermeasures where we've had to adapt for the very first time. But there we fall back again on the experience of the stakeholders, and we're just scenario planning every single day now. James mentioned some examples, Pierre mentioned some. From the sports side, we're working through the rules and regulations, for example, Janet, that deal with if an athlete or a team can't participate in a certain match, how do we adapt to that? If a number of technical officials for a certain reason can't be there for a session, how do we adapt for that? The key goals are always keeping everything safe and secure, but making sure competition can happen, and everything else around that is flexible. But from now on, it's really a scenario planning, things that have happened in other events and things that we could imagine potentially happening in Tokyo.
I can't imagine what your spreadsheets are like at the moment, guys. You know, your spreadsheets and, you know, on your wall, you've probably got these big posters of pen marks. What happens if this happens?
I can't. Our inbox.
Yeah. I can't even organize a party, let alone an Olympics.
The window, everyone.
Yeah, everyone's just like, right, this is how it's going to work. This is how it's going to run. Right. I think we can head back to the Zoom now. Some more questions that have come across. Who have we got there on the Zoom? Oh, I think Zoom might have just dropped off. We'll go back to Zoom in a moment. Let's pick up on the Menti. We've got, oh no, Zoom's back. Okay, we're going back to the Zoom. Hello, who's that?
Hello. Coucou tout le monde. Bonjour tout le monde.
Bonjour.
Bonjour.
Je vais en profiter pour prendre la parole et représenter un peu les athlètes français pour vous dire quelque chose.
I'll speak a bit of French. Take this opportunity to speak to you. In French, I would like to thank you for everything that you're doing for us, for our security. Everything that the Japanese are doing for us to protect us, everything that the IOC is doing. It'll be my first Games. I've been qualified twice. I was not chosen before by my country, so I'm really excited about these Games. And I'm looking forward to going to Tokyo.
Congratulations. Yeah. That's brilliant.
Bonne chance.
Good luck from James.
Oh, brilliant stuff. And you know, you mentioned that, didn't you, Kit, when you said this will be the first Games for so many, for so many athletes. Mm. And what a very different experience for them, though. But we still have to try and make it a special one. And do you have hopes that it still will be for them?
Oh, of course it will be special, but exactly as you say, roughly 70% of the athletes at any Games, it's their first Games, and it's about the same percentage that only go to one Games. So we have to focus on making sure that their experience is, number one, not only unique in all interpretations of the word, but really a special positive one, and they can focus on competition. Everything we're doing around the adaptations to the village, the periods of stay, all of this is focused on the competing athlete and making sure they've got a safe environment where they don't need to worry about anything other than their performance. That's everything that is driving us forward. And again, that's shared. That's shared across the NOCs, obviously. That's shared across the international federations. You heard from Seiko, a seven-time Olympian, as the president of the organizing committee, Makako as the sport director of the organizing committee, Pierre and everyone in the Games team. The athlete is the focus of what we do, and that really is what drives us forward every day, and it's what brings the whole movement together.
And that's pretty much why we're here, isn't it, Kirsty? You know, at the forum, just to make sure that everybody gets a chance to ask the right type of questions, to hear that level of information. And we've had these playbooks that have been published and everything else. And what's the reaction been like from the athlete community with their own playbook and the things that are inside?
No, it's been great. We've had such good calls with our network of global athletes, many of them all on the call today and joining us virtually. And I think the athletes are just excited that there's clarity for them in the playbooks. You know, there's a lot of clarity of what's going to happen and how it's all going to be. And I think that is the best thing that we can do for the athletes, is that they know it is going to be a unique Games. It's still going to be unique, though, and it's still going to be the Games, and it's going to be special. And we're going to, as you've heard from Kid and James and Pierre, that everyone's going to make it special. But it's good to also know that these are all the safety measures. And as we've heard from our athletes that have joined us, everyone is working towards making it safe for the athletes and for the Japanese people. And that is the biggest concept that's come out of the playbooks, is that it's going to be there and everyone knows what they're supposed to do and how they're supposed to do it and how to have fun at the Games.
And if I could, Janet, maybe just build on Kirsty's point there. I think one really important thing is the role that everyone involved in this forum can play. And there, the playbooks are in place. We're building all of the other information. But if I could just say that we've all got the really important role to play. Where the information has gone out to the athletes and they've been involved in briefings at a national level, a sport-specific or a global athlete call, there's really confidence where we do see any confusion is really where maybe that information hasn't got through to the individual athletes. So we just ask for any Athletes Commission representative to really be engaged with their NOC, with the International Federation, to make sure they've got all the information that is available and ensuring all of their athletes really have a good understanding of that information. Yeah. And that's really a key that all
share
of us can pick up.
Filter it down and share as much as possible.
But I guess that's why we're here on this panel, isn't it? To make sure that everybody has a right level of information, James, that they can pass down. And it's about making sure that all the stakeholders are on the same hymn sheet, singing the same song. Otherwise, that level of confusion can really hamper an athlete's performance.
Absolutely. And what we want to make sure is that the athlete, when they, again, get to their field of play, are not thinking about anything else other than their competition. Yeah. So everything that happens before, their flight ticket, how they arrive in Tokyo, how they get tested, etc., all of that stuff has got to have a lot of clarity behind it, so that their coach, their support staff, whether it's their friends and family, everyone understands what's going on, so that they know that the dining hall in the village, how it's going to operate, so that they can just go get their fuel, get ready for their training or their competition. And it is important to us to make sure that that clarity is there through the playbooks. And that was the reason that we put in place these playbooks, specifically so that we could give that explanation. Yeah. There's also been two versions of the playbook. There's a third one coming up in June, specifically because the situation is evolving. And we needed to, and each version is a bit clearer than the last one. So after the first one, we got that many questions. Now we've got this many. Hopefully we get to the game time and have a lot less.
We've got loads of questions here. I'm going to just throw one to Pierre here. It's come up for you, Pierre. It says, will all games participants and officials be required for vaccination in Tokyo? And that, it might be a tricky one to answer right now, because that might change further down the line. But if the games were tomorrow, what would the answer be? Oh, we've lost his sound. Okay.
No, back now.
Perfect.
No, I don't think it's a tricky question. We've said from the beginning that we, of course, and we are working with all the NOCs and all the partners to try and give opportunity to as many stakeholders as possible to have a possibility to be vaccinated. So this work we are doing, but we've said from the beginning that we would not make vaccination a prerequisite for participation to the games. So any athlete that would not have an opportunity to be vaccinated or will elect not to be vaccinated would not see his participation to the games being impacted. This was very important, something we discussed with the Athletes Commission and also the Medical Commission. Those are very key principles for us that we want, of course, to create as many means to secure the games, but we also want to make sure that we don't come in the way of the participation of the athletes to the games. So we have established, and James just mentioned it, a playbook which has a whole variety of measures which protect the delivery of the games, but vaccination is obviously contributing on top of that to a safe environment. This is why we are working with the NOCs and all the other partners to create those opportunities. But to go back to the initial question, no, it is not a prerequisite for your participation to the games.
And that's quite really encouraging information, isn't it, guys? Because I guess, Kirsty, there will be athlete commissions who are thinking, well, we're not going to be able to get our athletes, you know, in a position to be vaccinated anyway. So it's always moving. So that, I'm sure, for a lot of athletes is good news.
Yeah, 100%. And I think, as Pierre has already said, that we had those discussions. We were part of those discussions as a commission at the beginning. And it was all clear right from the get-go. Good. So looking forward to just getting to Tokyo now.
Yes, and I hope that's answered your question. Don't forget, when you use the Menti, make sure you put your name and your location so I know where you're asking these questions from. And if you have a question for the Zoom, just hit the hand raise button, and we'll get you on. We've got some more Zoom questions coming up right now. Hello, who's that up on our big screen?
Hello, this is Kotso Mokoena from South Africa. I'm the chairperson of the South African Olympic Athletes Committee, also a silver medalist at the Olympic Games 2008 in Beijing. With regards to the vaccinations, our country, it has actually started quite well. The athletes are actually getting their jabs, which is great. But my question is more of mental awareness centric. How important is it that there should be some sort of forums to help the athletes mentally during the games, because we know that these games are so unique, you know, in terms of they won't be able to interact with anybody. You know, it's more of going there, coming back to yourself, quarantining again. So is the platforms that athletes can join to actually assist with stimulation with their minds down there?
Kirsty, I think it's one for you. We did a big session yesterday, didn't we?
We did on
mental health, but this maybe this is a little bit more acute in the arse.
Like games, you know? Time.
Yeah, games.
Yeah,
time.
Yeah. Well, hi from my brother from my neighboring country, it's a great question, and we had some similar questions yesterday during our wellness and mental health panel. I think your question is more specific to during the games and this games, and then when athletes get home. Some athletes are going to have to go through quarantine, and that makes it even a little bit longer to then see family. So I think, I think what we need to do is really look at maybe potentially putting something together within the welcome kit for athletes, you know, a few little steps or some fun ideas of things that athletes can potentially do to just help them through those situations. And I'll ask the athlete commission and the team. I'm throwing another load of work onto the team. But I'm sure that there is something that we can do just to help athletes walk through that. And we also have, from the session yesterday, a proposal that I'm going to take to the IOC athlete commission is to come up with a workshop that we will deliver directly to athlete committees to help their athletes. Obviously, that will come after the games, but it's progress, work in progress. And if you all have any other ideas in how we can help our athletes at games time and when they come home, we'll have to go through quarantine, send them through to us and let's keep the discussion going.
Thank you.
Does that help?
A lot. Thank you so much.
Good. Thank you so much. Thank you. Brilliant stuff. Yeah, Kirsty, that's the thing, isn't it? Is making sure that at games time, people feel as prepared as possible, because it is going to be such a different experience to what maybe an experienced Olympian is. But I guess if it's your first games, you don't know any different. You know, it's a games. Like, you've still got to perform and do quite well. Yeah. So I'm going to head to the Mentimeter now. There's a question here that's come up, and it says, are there any more test events planned before the games? And if yes, what are the focus of these events for games preparation? Is that a kit question? I think that is a kit question.
Yeah, I can maybe make a start. And then pass over to Pierre, because this really links through to not only the events, but all of the operational readiness that James touched on and the delivery phase we're really in now. Look, we've had 13 individual test events in different sports throughout April and May, which really shows how intense the preparations are. You heard from Thomas, we've heard from other athletes that have been there in the diving event, the Atheletes, both in Sapporo for the marathon, the in-venue event at the Olympic Stadium there, unanimously really positive feedback from the athletes about the experience, the confidence in other areas. Between now and the games, we're moving the focus away from events as such, because you can imagine the venues are really going into their final preparations, just like the athletes, if you like, with all of the overlay for the broadcast, the result systems, all of that work now going on inside the venues. I think we've got an artistic swimming event that's still to come, which is really just an operational test. And then Pierre, it transitions really into all of those scenario planning and integration workshops we've got, where we get the federations, NOC reps, organizing committee ourselves, put an issue on the table and work it through in a real live time environment to make sure that everyone's understanding about roles and readiness. But Pierre, you could touch on maybe the build up to the games in that regard.
Yeah, no, thanks, Kit. Definitely right now we are in venues. The organizers are in the venues. The venue teams are working. They have a few more events, as mentioned by Kit, to have real life test opportunities. But the work is every day. They are finishing the overlay to make sure that everything is ready from that perspective. They are running through a number of exercises, making sure the teams, because very often, and that's the particularity of the games, they might be first-time athletes, but there are many first-time organizers in an organizing committee workforce, because this is the first time for this generation the games are coming to Tokyo. So there's a lot of elements that they have to work through in order to make sure that they are ready to react to all scenarios. We are testing, you know, ceremony services, transport services, food services. We know how important that is in the context of the game. So what will be the methodologies in the dining hall to, on one end, deliver the quality of food we need, but on the other end, making sure we respect the protocols that are needed when you do have to deliver food in the context we know. So all of those elements are really being looked through, the flows, how people are going to enter the venue, the signage to make sure you know where you're supposed to go. So all of that is being reviewed through operational walkthrough, talkthroughs, exercises, and again, the finishing touches on the venue and the elements. So it is very concrete now. If you go to venues, you can almost feel that tomorrow you could have the competition, and that feeling is fantastic to have. So we can't wait to welcome everybody here. It's going to be fantastic venues.
Pierre, can I just ask you, are you actually getting a chance to watch any sport and enjoy it? Are you, you know, are you having a good time out there?
At the moment, not so much because, you know, we are spending a lot of time preparing the exercises and working in the office with the organizing committee, but there has been a lot of sport and a number of my colleagues have been out there. I've seen some and fantastic venues again that show that the work which has been put on and that has been extended by 1 year is paying off. I think we will have fantastic backdrop for the athletes to shine. And I can't wait again for these opportunities to be given to the athletes, because for sure, the Japanese people with whom we should be very thankful for all the work they have put to those games and the efforts which they had to add to what they are already doing last year, they can't wait also to see the people going into those venues and seeing their hard work pay off. So very excited about this next 57 days to come.
Brilliant stuff. Okay, I think we can head over to the Zoom now. Someone's going to be beamed in to our studio live here in Lausanne. Hello.
Hi, my name is Rody. I am a shooter, been to 6 Olympics, so lots of experience with the Olympics.
Wow.
I have a question for you guys. I was actually texted this from one of my shooters or fellow shooters in another country who is currently tested positive for COVID. And the question that I've been asked is, obviously, once you're tested positive with COVID, the treatment is always an urgent decision to the athlete. And the doctors, we know that the treatment must begin and, you know, it's really consolidated around the world. But basically, they're asking me about the therapeutic use exemption, if there is already an approved one by WADA, as athletes testing positive with COVID and going through this treatment, is there any steps that WADA has taken to make that a little easier as we grow closer to the Olympics, as we know that that can be very difficult for the athlete?
This is an example of a question where it's moving parts, so fast moving, you know, who takes it on? Is it a WADA situation? Is it a low cog? Is it IOC? Like, who takes on a question like that, Kirsty? In fact, on the panel, even, like, who would be the best person to take a question Kirstie. Like that on? Kirsty, everyone just goes to Kirsty.
Not Kirsty. No, we have someone from our medical team who is standing by, so we can maybe bring him up, because I think that's a very medical specific question, yeah. Right? So we want to ensure that our athletes are getting the right up-to-date
information
on that. Yeah. And I'd rather have
Pal. I didn't mean Pal. To put anybody
on the spot. Pal, there he is. There's Pal.
How you doing, Pal?
Dr. Motto.
He's a doctor.
He's a doctor, everyone, so don't panic.
but no, he's definitely way more qualified than me to answer this correctly for everyone.
Did you manage to hear the question?
Yes. Fantastic. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Kirsty. Yeah, the WADA is not linked to COVID, but we know that some people who had COVID in the past and has some viral shaving cannot get into a PCR test without having a positive test. We are working internally in Japan with experts to try to let these athletes with a COVID test enter in Japan, even without having symptoms.
Does that help there completely with that answer?
I think it's more referring to like the therapeutic use exemption, because they're wanting to prescribe the medicines for COVID to combat it. And the athletes are having to make that decision very quickly prior to possibly getting the therapeutic or the TUE. And so I was just wondering if WADA or IOC has maybe looked into some exemptions on that or taken steps to try to ensure that the athletes, when they're going through this, as we grow closer to the Olympics, getting that exemption can be very challenging and may not be enough time. So that's why I was just asking more specifically to the TUE.
I got it now. So it would be very useful if you can send us the specific medication, because then we can look at the specific treatment. So I don't know if you can put it in the chat or send it by email, but it would be good.
Yeah, because I think...
Just wanted to add something. One important element that is also for the athlete good to know is that during the games, we will have a result advisory expert group on site with some of the best physicians that understand what it takes to look at medical records and understand how it can affect the results of testing. And we will be having that as part of all of the analysis process for all of the tests that could show some irregularities or complexity. So we want to make sure that we have the best scientific analysis on these matters and that the athletes or the federations or the NOCs feel that they can get the specifics understood and a very scientifically based response coming to them every time they ask for it.
Brilliant stuff.
And we'll we'll take this question and pass it on to WADA just to make them, you know, known, let them know that this could possibly be happening and to try and speed up any specific TUEs in relation to COVID treatments. So we'll pass that along to them so that can also be expedited.
Great question, Kim. Thank you so much. Because I think that probably is a situation that will happen across the world. People mm-hmm. will be mm-hmm. really deliberating about what type of medication they take before coming to the game. So thank you so much for coming on and asking that. Brilliant stuff. Thank you very much. Okay, let's head to the mentee. It says here, how often will I be tested and what kind of tests will be used? That's going to be quite a different scenario, isn't it, Pierre? When you think about all of the different kinds of tests that are available, we think about the different time blocks that are across the world and what the standard is. What is it going to be in Tokyo?
So yeah, obviously it's a very important part of our approach. Testing is a very important way to secure the games. So how is it going to be? I think now everybody is aware that you would have to take two tests prior to departure within 96 hours. You will be tested when you get to the airport. It will be an antigen test that you will have to take. And then you will be tested every day, unless there are specific circumstances that do not allow for it, but you will be tested every day throughout the time you stay in Japan. So this is the idea. The sequence of testing is something we've worked through with our expert panel. It basically is a saliva test that will be an antigen test first. And if there is an issue with that first sample analysis, it will be taken from the same sample another PCR analysis. So it will be two tests from the first sample to try and minimize the number of false positives that I think everybody is familiar with. And in the case where the two tests lead to inconclusive results or positive results, then there will be what we called a nasopharyngeal test, PCR, that will be taking place to make sure that there is no decision regarding someone being isolated or excluded from the games without having gone through this whole sequence. It's very important to us that we built a process where everybody feels he had as many chances as possible to be tested with the latest technology and to have a result, which is confirmed also by the processes we have built. So it is a process which has three steps, but really only two times for the athletes to have to give a sample if need be. And from what we understand, this should allow to minimize the number of false positives, which again, we want to avoid to minimize the distraction to the competition. And in the end, obviously, also minimize the number of cases that we could have.
Across the test events, Kit, how important was it to make sure that that protocol was right? Because the stuff of nightmares would be that you turn up to a games in the shape of your life and a false positive comes along and you're then unable to get a result that actually would allow you to compete.
Yeah, I think the two main points are, number one, certainty in terms of the process. So the athletes are very aware about what tests are being done when, and the timelines of turnaround, how that impacts on their training and competition and so on when they find out about the results. The second one is just being very clear about what types of tests are being done. And I think Pierre outlined absolutely clearly the types of tests that would be done and the sequence of those testings. We should be clear that at a number of the test events we've had, we haven't had the games time models of testing in place because they've been operating under international federation rules or, in fact, different requirements from the hosts in Japan at different times. So we have been very clear about what is different from the test events to the games times themselves. But exactly as Pierre has said, we really, through the playbooks, have tried to be very clear in that. And again, that's why using every one of these remaining 57 days to communicate with the athletes, engage with the athletes, be very clear about what the plans are, and answer all of those types of questions that have come back, including the one from Kim most recently, is really vital because the planning is there. We just need to give that certainty to the athletes now.
Perfect. Okay, just head to the Zoom. Let's see who's there on the Zoom. Are they ready to be beamed in to the studio? Are they going to give us a surprise face? I'm going to keep on talking until she realizes that she's on camera, and there she goes. Hello. What's your name and where are you dialing in from? You're on mute. Can't hear you. There we go. Let's turn that.
Ahora sí me escuchan.
We can hear you.
Yes, we can hear you. Thank you. Well, good morning, good afternoon, good evening or night to everyone. My name is Julia Garisoain from Argentina. My partner, Walter Perez, who's president, is here with me. I was also a president of the Athletes Commission, and I'm now working for Tokyo. So first of all, thank you so much for this absolutely excellent forum. These are the good things that we can learn from this pandemic. That is to know that thanks to technology, more than 2,000 athletes can work together via Zoom. So my congratulations to you all, and let's keep working along these lines. My second point, we are very concerned about mental issues, mental health. So we look forward to all these efforts that are being made to take care of our athletes in Tokyo. Argentina certainly is still going through a very tough time in terms of the pandemic. We are working very hard to ensure that all our athletes will get to Tokyo in full health. But it's a very critical moment for us. And that is why our major effort at the moment, and we know this will depend, of course, on our joint work. We have to all take care of each other, take care of those next to us and close to us, of course. So from the Argentine Athletes Commission, we see this as like we're a very, very big army of people. We've worked very hard in former years so that athletes will just focus on their work, their training, their discipline. We've wanted them to have their minds focused on their sport. But now we're making huge endeavors to ensure that athletes are not only focused on their skills and sports, but also on self-care. I have a suggestion and a request, hoping that you can help us. We're now preparing a pack, a kit, to reinforce communication and information with athletes. They will be receiving a flyer, and they will have a brochure or some kind of dossier in their hotel room. And the rule book that we're designing is excellent. It's absolutely great. We're on our second edition of the rule book now. And we believe that if we can do this properly, we want help for the 10 commandments, as we call them, those 10 top issues that cannot be forgotten and that athletes have to remember 24/7. We want to guarantee that those 10 commandments are read by everybody, memorized and not forgotten. So if you could help us in setting up these 10 commandments with those 10 absolutely essential ideas that they cannot forget when they're in Tokyo, that would be of great help. Thank you.
That's a brilliant idea, a great idea to be able to share from all for all the commissions that are here. And do remember that you can get in touch with other athlete representatives that are working with their commissions across the globe to be able to do that. But is that something, Kirsty, that a lot of the athlete commissions could probably work alongside and make sure that essentially you've got your own type of setup and protocols and procedures to make sure you have a really safe games in Tokyo?
Yeah, 100%. And thank you, Julia. We were all just saying we love the idea. We're totally going to steal the Ten Commandments. And make more work for the commission and the team. But we love the idea of taking those 10 commandments and putting it into the welcome packs, which now will be on the phones that all of the athletes get. So we love that idea. We'll definitely look at doing that. I think the other ways in which to support that is through the NOC grants. You know, those are great ways that you've just said you're putting pamphlets and flyers together for your athletes going to Tokyo. Those are great ideas that NOC athlete commissions can apply for the grant and help their athletes better prepare for Tokyo and know exactly what's to come. So love it.
Brilliant stuff.
Yes, extremely useful, but I must say that we have a lot of information, so much information, in fact, that sometimes we forget the very basics, like this great news that we received about the application. We knew that there was something there. We didn't know where to find the information, and this, we believe, cannot happen when it comes to the safety of our athletes. So we want to give our athletes these 10 basic commandments. So, and those who are more experienced and have done games before might be aware, but the new rookies might not be aware. So those of us who are more veteran and seasoned in all of this want to relay this information to our athletes, the younger ones, the rookies, so that they're safe and don't miss anything.
Sure. That's a brilliant idea. And I guess that's what experience is for when you look at, you know, the scope of the teams that will be going out to Tokyo. But Kirsty, you make such a good point, actually, about that solidarity grant and people being able to use that within their commissions for things like this, isn't it? And that's another creative idea. We spoke in detail yesterday about the type of support that athletes can get. So, you know, James is the man when it comes down to making sure that you apply for that grant and you'll be able to then definitely filter down whatever program it is for your athletes to make sure they are well prepared just for Tokyo and beyond, because this is something, you know, I feel that we'll live with for a significant amount of time, and there will be things in place that that will be here pretty much forever. So not to sound doom and gloom, but definitely for the better, I think. It really just makes us think about safety a little bit more. Let's move on to the Mentimeter. Can you please describe what a typical day will be for an athlete in the Olympic Village? Please emphasize the peculiarities marked by COVID-19, Pierre. I guess, you know, the freedom that so many of us know that we have in the village and roaming around and getting to know Tokyo, it may not be the case this time round, will it?
No, and I'm sure James will compliment, because when it comes to the Olympic Village, he's also the man. He's not only the man of solidarity, but really has been able to see in the playbooks, there will be limitations regarding the movements of the athletes. That probably is the biggest difference, in the sense that we want to make sure you can have an experience when it comes to the sporting side, but to protect the village, to protect the athletes, it's important that we also avoid people putting themselves in situations which could mean that they could be exposed to the virus. We feel in the village we can deliver a protected environment. Outside, it's much more difficult. So the journeys will really be between all of the key locations that athletes have to go to, the Olympic Village, of course, the training venues, the competition venues, and a few other places where they have to go for the purpose of their presence on the ground. But there will be no opportunity to go roam around town and discover Tokyo. We know it's very unfortunate, but we feel that this is the price to deliver safe and successful games. So this will be, I would say, the biggest change when it comes to the experience of the athletes. Then, of course, there will be the testing part, which will happen in the village on a daily basis. But we are working with James and also with the organizing committee to create the smoothest possible policy to allow for this testing to not be too much of a distraction. And then around the village, there are also obviously a number of activities which you may have seen in the past that would not take place anymore. Just again, to not create situations which could be conducive to having more situation in the village. The dining hall as well, when it comes to the policies to access it, this is also quite important. So I would say overall, the experience that we have worked on, we feel is still a very good one, but there are a few things which had to change for the purpose of us feeling confident that we have delivered what we wanted to deliver, which is a safe experience for the athletes.
And James, you know, you've got a wealth of experience when it comes down to, you know, big organizing committees, London 2012, Baku 2015. This is a different experience for you, I guess. And that must have been quite hard, taking out certain things that you know make the games, but actually there's a balance of what makes the games versus what keeps people safe.
Yes, I agree. I think there's one thing to say, first of all, the Tokyo village will be extraordinary. It's a beautiful village. It's stunning. I think the experience that the athletes and the officials that are staying there will have will really be next to nothing. But it's true that there are things that we've had to adapt. And one of the biggest things is the period of stay policy that we've put in place, where we're limiting access into the village prior to competition 5 days prior for athletes, and they have to leave within 48 hours after their competition ends. That's a big change for athletes because a lot of the experience happens in that second week when athletes have finished their competition. It's normally the swimmers.
Yes.
And and they stick around and they cause noise and et cetera. And that becomes a difference.
Not all the time.
But it is a change in the way the villages operate. Yeah. But it's to what Pierre just said. We need to make sure that the village operates for the competition, make sure that it's safe and secure. And that's one of the biggest changes we've had. We don't want to replicate that in future games because we understand that that's integral. The village life is integral to an athlete's experience, and they often leave there. And remember that, remember all the people they've met in the main dining hall. They also remember the ceremonies, which is also a very special moment. And that those are some of the key differentiators in this competition.
Track and field, guys, did you hear that? The swimmers are leaving. They go. So track and field, boxing.
It'll be so quiet without us.
And all the second week, guys, they go. We sleep, we compete. This is great news. Fantastic news. Let's head over to the Zoom and see who wants to have a chat. Hello. Can you see us and hear us? Hello.
Hello.
Hi, what's your name and where are you dialing in from?
Amal Mudhish, Amin Aam, Lajnat
al-Riyadi. Amal Mudhish, I'm the chairman of the Athletes Commission in Yemen.
Hello.
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 I would like, first of all, the Athletes Commission of the IOC for having organized this event and for the care and attention they're giving us. I have a question regarding the camps for the athletes who are going to compete in Tokyo. There are some difficulties in having external camps. Why aren't camps organized within Tokyo? I think everything will be fine if they were to be organized inside Tokyo and it'll be safe.
Yeah, that's quite a hard one, isn't it, James? To think that you'd want every single nation to descend on Tokyo for a camp. You know, there are a number of things around that, aren't there?
Absolutely. I mean, there's a complexity, obviously, to preparing teams and athletes for the games. And I mentioned it yesterday, there are pre-games training camps that are organized by the NOCs, but also by sports and continental associations. They're across the country. They're not necessarily in Tokyo. We believe that that's a good way for the Japanese people to have an experience of the games across the country. It's also a good way for the NOCs and the athletes that are coming to the games to be able to interact with different areas in the country. All of those pre-games training camps follow the same principles that are in the playbooks. So the playbooks that are operational at games time, in venues, etc., the host cities and the prefectures that are hosting the pre-games training camps will be following the same concepts relating to testing, relating to creating bubbles, etc. And so for us, we're very confident that those camps will be safe and secure, and it will allow then athletes to transit from there into the village to be able to start their preparation in the venues, and whether it be training or the competition venues.
Hopefully that helps. Does that give you a bit more clarity as to why that can't be the case?
Thank you very much. I appreciate your answer. Thank you.
We appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much. Right. I think we're coming towards the end of this panel now. It's been a big one. It's been a really, really mammoth one. I want to say a massive thank you to Pierre all the way out there in Tokyo. And it is so encouraging to hear everything you're doing over there and to see you live here at the forum. I guess it gives the athletes so much hope as well. James, Kirsty, and Kit, thank you so much for your hard work on this panel. We didn't get round to all of the questions. I'm so sorry, but we will compile them and do our best to get back to you. Okay, so thank you very, very much.
Years ago, I thought, yes, I'll do something different. I'll set up a business. And somehow, something was lacking, that push, you know? And now I look back now and think, well, why didn't I come to get to know an entrepreneurship program? And today, beginning of 2021, I thought, wow, isn't it great that I took on the risk that I did this and that I was able to access the program and the mentors and that they gave me those words of support, of encouragement to do things differently, to be an entrepreneur, to set up a business with a different structure. The athletes 365 Business Accelerator Program has helped me not only in my business but also in my personal life.
Okay, before we move on, I just want to remind you to get your questions in for the IOC president later. He's going to be with me right here, live on this stage, in this studio with all of you guys. So go and grab your phone, head to menti.com, that's menti.com, and type in the code on the screen, 17699654. Or better still, use your phone and scan that QR code. Send us your questions. And please do not forget to put your name and your location. It makes a huge difference for us here to be able to answer them. And we'll put them directly to the IOC president, okay? Don't forget your name. I'll come and find you if you do, okay? And before that, though, I want to bring Kirsty back to this stage. She's got a super important update on Olympic Agenda 2020+5.
Thank you, Jeanette. After a fantastic session and discussing about Olympic Games and all the preparations, I am excited to present to you Olympic Movement Strategic Roadmap for the next 4 years, the Olympic Agenda 2020+5. But before looking ahead, let's quickly reflect on the last few years. Through Olympic Agenda 2020, launched in 2014, the IOC and our commission strengthened the support and positioning of athletes within the Olympic movement. These recommendations covered key areas through some historical initiatives, from athlete representation to protection from doping and competition manipulation, career transition, and athletes' well-being. Significant actions were also taken to engage with athletes and athlete representatives through digital means and in person. These actions were complemented by a wide range of programs and financial resources available through Olympic Solidarity and targeted at supporting athletes and their entourage. As we know, the world is ever-changing, which means athletes' needs are changing too. The slogan, change or be change, is what inspired Olympic Agenda 2020, and it remains more relevant now than ever. Through the launch of Olympic Agenda 2020+5, the athlete-related recommendations will address this changing landscape through a number of concrete and meaningful actions. Some of these recommendations you have already been discussing during the breakout sessions over the weekend. And it is very apparent to me how important it is that as athlete representatives, we work together in order to maximize the impact that these recommendations can have. So there are 15 recommendations. Don't worry, I'm not going through all of them. Within Olympic Agenda 2020+5, and many of them are related to athletes, directly and indirectly. Recently, we have seen the rise of some universal trends, and many of these trends have been accelerated by COVID-19. As challenging as the circumstances may appear right now, if we draw the right lessons, we can seize the opportunities that these challenges offer us. The 15 recommendations in general include 5 key trends. First, the need for greater solidarity within and among societies. Second, the growth in digitalization. Thirdly, the urgency of achieving sustainable development. Fourth, the growing demand for credibility of organizations and institutions. And fifth and finally, the need to build resilience in the face of the financial and economic consequences that have resulted from COVID-19. The athlete-related recommendations will address this changing landscape through a number of concrete and meaningful actions. And today, I'd like to focus on 2 recommendations which have the greatest focus on athletes, Recommendation 3 and Recommendation 5. And through constructive and meaningful collaboration with all of you, with the IFs, the NOCs, and everyone across our movement, together we can make a huge difference for our fellow athletes. So first, Recommendation 3, which talks about reinforcing athletes' rights and responsibilities. This recommendation outlines 6 concrete actions. Each of these actions have a clear purpose. And I'd like to highlight the key points. The first action is about reinforcing the athlete representation across the Olympic movement. Within the IOC, we have recently established an athletes department, reinforcing that athletes really are at the heart of our movement. Also, the IOC will continue to put a lot of effort into increasing the employment opportunities for Olympians and elite athletes within the IOC and across the Olympic movement. To ensure that we are all effective, the IOC-AC will continue to support you in your role. And we encourage you to actively engage with your respective NOC and IF to ensure that you are fully benefiting from all the resources available through the IOC and Olympic Solidarity. The next action is about funding. Here, we focus on 3 key points. First, as you heard yesterday, and we are very happy that Olympic Solidarity budget for athlete development for the next 4 years has been increased by 25%. Additionally, we will work with Olympic top partners and broadcasters to develop innovative programs to support athletes. As you know, we've started this already with Airbnb, Intel, Samsung, and P&G. We want to build on these initiatives and develop new initiatives with tops and broadcasters. And finally, We know our stakeholders are taking lots of actions to support athletes, and we are encouraging everyone to provide transparency on how they support their athletes. On the next actions, we focus on two elements. First, increasing our direct engagement with you, our fellow athletes, through Athlete 365 and other digital means. Secondly, we will enhance the e-learning opportunities and resources for athletes and their entourage. In the next action, we want to reinforce the athletes' rights and responsibilities within the Olympic movement. Here, we will promote the roles of athletes and Olympians as ambassadors. When it comes to the athletes' declaration, we will continue to work closely with you, IFs, and NOCs to ensure that all organizations adopt and implement the declaration. We will help you by developing guidelines and sharing best practices to support you and your respective NOCs and IFs along this journey. So the next action focuses on the role of athletes, personnel, and entourage. We want to increase our continual engagement with you and your support team. But we also want to go beyond the traditional athlete support team and ensure we develop dedicated engagement and support programs that are targeted for managers, agents, and sponsors. The final action of recommendation 3 is about increasing the recognition of Olympians and our Olympian community. We want to celebrate and raise the profile of all our Olympians, not only during the games, but also in between games. This will help us to strengthen our Olympian communities, both locally and globally. We know Olympians and athletes are the best ambassadors for our movements. So let's show the world too. The second recommendation is recommendation 5, to further strengthen safe sport and protection of clean athletes. This is an extremely important recommendation with a focus on mental and physical well-being of athletes and protection of clean athletes from doping and competition manipulation. Firstly, with the focus on holistic well-being of athletes, both mental and physical health, we will take a number of actions that will strengthen our effort in this area. We will roll out International Safeguarding Office certificate and encourage all sports organizations to establish a safeguarding officer position. Finally, we will continue to support NOCs in this area through resources available from Olympic Solidarity. In the area of mental health, we will continue to increase our resources available to athletes and their entourage. As you know, the IOC recently launched a toolkit to support athletes and all stakeholders in this very important area. We will also continue to work with the World Health Organization to promote the physical and mental health benefit of sport. In the second part of this recommendation, we focus on anti-doping and prevention of competition manipulation. On anti-doping, the IOC will continue to support WADA and ITA in their effort for the development and implementation of anti-doping programs across the sports movement, including the professional leagues and college sport. Together with all stakeholders and governments, we will support funding for more effective programs, for more innovative testing, intelligence gathering, and investigations. When it comes to prevention of competition manipulation, together with partners and actors in the field, for example, Interpol and United Nations Office on Drug and Crime, the IOC will strengthen its efforts in the area of prevention and competition manipulation. And we will also continue our efforts to increase awareness about this topic among athletes and all organizations. And we will encourage international federations to assess and enhance their refereeing and judging systems and programs with clear rules and regulations. So, with all of this in mind, let's look at how your feedback from the breakout sessions is going to help us implement Olympic Agenda 2020 plus 5. There were four main outcomes on how we can collectively achieve this in collaboration with all of our partners, stakeholders across the movement. We will work together to be more effective as athlete representatives and commit to implementing the athlete-focused recommendations. We will widen our engagement and reach with athlete support teams and work on the adoption of athletes' declaration. So if I leave you with one message, that message is through constructive and meaningful collaboration with all of you, the IFs, our NOCs, and everyone across the movement. Together, we can make a huge difference for our athletes. We need to know, and I'm sure all of you know, that we are stronger together, and we will achieve more through meaningful collaboration and dialogue with our entire athlete community and stakeholders across our movement. And so before welcoming the IOC president, here is a video that will hopefully remind all of us about the special Olympic moments.
Thank you very much for that update, Kirsty. And guys, honestly, this is it now. This is the moment we've all been waiting for day two of this International Athletes Forum. And we often forget as athletes the wider structure of how things come together. And it wasn't until I retired that I realized the scope of events like the Olympics and the different areas that need to work in harmony. Someone has to be in charge of every single aspect. It's not a job that I envy, but there is a man who does it very well. And ladies and gentlemen, now's your chance to really make sure that your voice is heard. I hope you're comfortable. I hope you've got your popcorn. This could be long because in 2019, he welcomed you to fire free with the questions and you really did. I'd like to welcome to the stage, President of the IOC, Thomas Bach.
Good to see you all, if even only remotely. I hope you're doing well. And thank you, Jeanette, for the very kind introduction.
You can give them a wave. They can all wave it. Okay.
Hi.
Okay, so how the session will work, Mr. President, I will be picking up all the questions here on my little device. And
let them give a choice.
Yeah, come on the Zoom as well.
You have the choice now between an introduction speech of mine or a fire free with questions session. If you ask my advice, I would recommend you to opt for the fire-free, because my speeches are known to be on the more on the longer side. So you would have to be listening for 1.5 hours otherwise.
Okay, I'm going to take my seat here then. Okay, right, I'm going to take my seat here. I've got your questions, guys.
Okay, so
let's put your hands up and have a look and see. I think
fire free.
We've got someone right here coming up on the Zoom. Is this side? We've got someone coming up on the Zoom. Okay. Hello.
Good morning.
What's your name?
Good evening. Good afternoon. My name is Facundo Lezza. I am an Argentinian sailor. I represented my country in Rio 2016, and we represented again in Tokyo in a few months. I will go straight to the point and be as short as possible. I am here before you to tell you that my international federation, World Sailing, has changed 5 out of 10 events for the Paris 2024 Olympics, leaving the only event suited for 85 plus kilo male athletes out of the slate, failing to respect their own all physique policy, because sailing is a weight sensitive sport. I am 100 kilos, 190 centimeters tall, and without your help, I will be excluded and discriminated from the Olympic family after Tokyo. I apologize if this is not the right mean, the right way, or the right place to expose, but I am not just speaking in behalf of myself. I'm speaking in behalf of hundreds of sailors around the world and in behalf of future generations of big athletes that will not have the opportunity of becoming part of the Olympic family. I would really appreciate your help in this matter, Mr. President. I am at your full disposal, and I would like to thank everyone here for this big opportunity of expressing myself. For the last 3 years, I've been trying to make my voice heard, but I have been ignored by my international federation, and this opportunity means a lot to me. Thank you very much. These are difficult times, so be safe, and hopefully we will meet in Tokyo.
Thank you very much for your question. And don't worry, here is the right place for every question anybody may want to raise. And congratulations for the qualification to Tokyo, first of all. But you know, the putting together the Olympic program is maybe the most difficult endeavor in the Olympic movement, because so many things have to be taken into consideration. For reasons you know, we cannot have in the Olympic program necessarily, you know, all disciplines of all sports, because otherwise the size of the Olympic Games would explode, and we would not find any organizers for the Olympic Games anymore. And secondly, with regard to the program and the choice of the disciplines, this is in the responsibility of the respective international federations, because you know, there are running the sport day by day outside the Olympic Games, and they know best and should know best how they want to develop their sport, how they want to take new disciplines on board, how they want to safeguard the interest of athletes of other disciplines. So it's extremely, extremely difficult. And in this context, you know, we have we are following the way that in many federations, you know, we say, okay, we can accommodate so many events means so many medals, and then so many athletes participating. And then it's up to you, International Federation, to make a proposal. And then this proposal has to be discussed there with the organizing committees, with the International Federation, of course. And this is what our program commission is doing. And then finding the best way. And so there was in your case also a proposal there for, you know, offshore sailing, where there were some concerns with regard to the universality of the participation, with regard to the cost there of the event and the security of the event. No need to explain to you what it means to have and to create security for an offshore race, and also with regard to the cost this event would mean for the National Olympic Committees, because it's not offshore sailing is not a low-cost endeavor, as you know. So there are many, many points to be taken into consideration. And then, you know, also, again, the interest of the athletes. There you're referring to a very specific point. You know, this is your size and your weight. This is a problem we also are facing in other sports. You know, not every sport is necessarily the right sport for an athlete of a certain height or a certain weight, and there a balance has always to be found. And this again, you know, we leave in the hands thereof the international federations, who on the other hand, you know, are always also, you know, trying to make sure that you can compete then in world championships and in other events, and can at least on this level then continue there your career. So let us see what will happen now. There is our program commission, as I said, will have this discussion in the next couple of weeks. And then based on this recommendation, and after they have consulted with everybody, then the IOC Executive Board will have to take a decision. Sorry that I cannot promise you more than this at this moment.
Thank you very much for your time and for your attention.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hope that leaves you feeling a little bit more encouraged. I really do. Okay, I think we've got more questions that are coming up on the Zoom for you. So who is this beaming in to the studio now to speak to us here in Lausanne? Hello, what's your name and what's your question for the president?
Hi.
Hi, everyone. Christopher here from the Cyprus NOC Athletes Commission. So the IOC has been doing a great job in promoting our voice as athletes and by bringing the athlete community closer together. We also appreciate the transparency of the IOC towards us. Still, a lot of important information gets lost on national level because of lack of transparency from the NOCs. So in your opinion, Mr. Bach, what needs to be done, or what is the IOC doing to promote transparency within the NOCs and to fight corruption on national level?
No, thank you very much. This is indeed an important question. You know, and reminds me of my own time as a chair of an athletes commission, and then also in the IOC athletes commission, because communication, reaching out to the athletes was always a challenge. But we are now addressing this on different sides. You know, one is that we hope that with our digital communication strategy, we can more and more reach out directly to you and to the athletes on the national level, like we are doing here with this forum, like you can do and interact on Athletes 365 on the platform. And so that we have a direct communication, and that we need not to talk to each other through the many filters, you know, be it then NOCs, be it IFs, be it national federations, be it media, whatever. What we are looking for is the direct contact and your direct input. So this is one part. The other part is that with regard to transparency, that we have already encouraged, but I admit that this needs some more strength, maybe, to become there very transparent with all the flows of their money, as the IOC does, you know, with our annual report, with all the auditing, with everything. This we want to see also on the national level and on the IF level. And for them also to explain then in more detail and in detail, you know, how they support their athletes and how they develop their sports with all the money coming in. So also, you know, to so for everybody to see what do they need for administration, and how much is invested in the projects, what is happening on the ground, what amount of money is arriving where and how. And there I can only promise, you know, then listening to you, because this confirms also some other questions we got, that we really will have to look into a way how we can enforce this call for transparency also on this level more. When it comes to corruption, what you are also mentioning, there again, we are working on different levels. With regard to the NOCs, for instance, the NOCs are regularly audited by an independent auditor, which we are sending there to the NOC, so that during one Olympiad, each NOC is at least audited once. And if you know, we feel something, we smell something, then this audit also is happening very targeted. If there is a reason to believe that something is going wrong there, then the NOC Relations Department, I think you have met James McLeod just in the previous session, then they are sending the auditors. When it comes to the wider area of corruption, there inside the IOC, I think I do not need to repeat. I guess our CEO, Lana Haddad, has explained all this, our robust anti-corruption system. But maybe just to add that there, we are very closely working together with the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crimes, which Kirsty has also just mentioned, that we are working together there with many governments around the world, that we are working together with Interpol and Europol and other organizations in an initiative which is called IPEX. So this is an initiative by the IOC together with some partners, which enables us then in cooperation with the governments to address corruption, where we are looking for a harmonization of the laws, but where we have also access, you know, then to the law enforcement authorities who have much more power than any international federation or the IOC. You know, they can do the investigation. They can hear witnesses. They can do then the job we need in order to fight corruption in an efficient way. And this IPEX is working pretty well. And right now, in I think in a couple of days, even the United Nations General Assembly will discuss this fight against corruption in sport. And there, our cooperation with the UNODC and this IPEX initiative will play a major role in the United Nations General Assembly, so to get as many people as possible on board.
Does that help?
Yeah, definitely. Thank you very much.
Fantastic.
Oh, thank you.
Brilliant stuff. Thank you. Okay, there are so many more questions. There's loads of you that are trying to get into our studio here in Lausanne. We're going to try and get through as many as possible. Someone else is coming up on the Zoom, Mr. President, to come into our virtual studio. Do you like our studio, Mr. President? Do you like
it? Yeah, looks great.
You think so? Yeah?
But I even like the advice that you need you need slightly shorter answers. But I told you before, you know, it's high risk to give me the microphone. And,
So, who's this that's beamed into our studio?
Hi, my name's Heather Daly Donofrio, and I'm the chair of the Athletes Commission for the International Golf Federation, calling in here from Florida in the U.S. Well, I'm a retired athlete. I'm not an Olympian, so I'm always, you know, very honored and humbled to be a very small part of the Olympic movement. And I really don't have a question, but, you know, wanted to take a couple of minutes, if okay, President Bach, to, I guess, deliver, just offer some words of reassurance to the athletes and to those who are working so hard to deliver these games, that everything's going to be okay. Like, we are going to have a great and safe Olympic Games in Tokyo. You know, we've been lucky in golf that we've been competing throughout COVID for about a year. And we've been working through all of the same steps as the IOC and Tokyo 2020 is working through the games. And, you know, I know a lot of athletes haven't been around the world, haven't been as lucky as we have to be competing. So I know that the idea of going to Tokyo and being faced with this long list of protocols may seem overwhelming, and it can naturally create some nervousness. But, you know, in golf, we've been doing it for a year, and I think that nervousness is okay. And we need to recognize that and embrace that. And that's why having forums such as these, so we can ask questions, and why the playbook and good communication is so important. But, you know, golf was the first major professional sport to come back. And, you know, we've been holding tournaments around the world, Europe, Asia, Middle East, the Americas, and albeit it's a smaller scale than the Olympics, you know, we've been able to cross these borders and continents safely and successfully, not just for the athletes, but also the communities and the countries in which we play. And everything I've read coming out of the IOC and the playbooks and heard today, I'm just super confident that, you know, IOC in Tokyo will deliver the same for the Olympic games. You know, it's all about discipline, preparation, just as athletes, you know, prepare and train for their sports, you know, preparing for an Olympic Games in COVID time. It's a painstaking process, you know, to cover all of the bases. And it takes a lot of hard work. And just want to thank all those who were involved. You know, we've been living through similar playbooks for a year. So, you know, from a golf perspective, we're lucky because we know what to expect. And we were just in, we brought our tour to Thailand and Singapore a couple of weeks ago and, you know, under very similar protocols as we're going to experience in the games. And, you know, it's a rapidly changing environment. I have full confidence that the IOC and Tokyo 2020 will continue to adjust and adapt based on the advice of the medical experts and the WHO. And, you know, I think as athletes, you know, we just need to be flexible. We need to be ability and adjust as we go. We need to be prepared for that. And, you know, I think the IOC is doing a great job in clearly communicating kind of what the protocols are. And I think, you know, if we're prepared and we know exactly what to expect and how things will be managed through testing and all the protocols, you know, that's going to set us all up for success. And that's why these forums with you, President Bach, and the Athletes Commission are so important. And, you know, while we know the experience will be different, just as when we go to our tournaments this year, it's been different. You know, you have to think of those protocols as all part of the preparation, just like you're preparing for your sport. And I can absolutely assure you that once any athlete, you know, steps on that field or the court in the pool, you know, all that worry about the COVID and the protocols and the testing, it all goes away. And it just becomes about, you know, the athlete's team and the dream of becoming an Olympic medalist. So again, just wanted to say thank you on behalf of the IGF and golf. And again, know how much time and effort this takes. I've been running our COVID protocols here with the LPGA for a year and can't wait to get, I know our athletes can't wait to get Tokyo. I'll be there for 2 weeks myself for the men's and women's golf competition and look forward to seeing everybody there.
Fantastic. Sure.
No, thank you very much for your kind encouragement there. You were only, you know, with one point, I think you were too humble. You said you're a small part of the Olympic movement. In the Olympic movement, there are no small and big parts. There are only parts. And we're all the same and striving for the same goal. And in this case, for a safe Olympic Games in Tokyo. And, you know, thank you for all the support and also the encouragement to respect the playbooks. I just, you know, wanted also to encourage you that on top of the playbooks, you take the opportunity whenever it arises to get vaccinated. Because this will still increase the safety there for everybody, for yourself, for all your fellow athletes and for the Japanese people. So please, you know, if ever you have the opportunity and you know we are working for this with your NOCs, then accept the vaccination. And I can tell you, I got my two shots there and you still see me in good shape, at least at the beginning of this grilling situation. Let's wait then for the end.
Thank you so much for your question. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. More thoughts, actually. And it's really nice. We do welcome suggestions. We do welcome everything to be directed towards us here in the studio. But we have over 100 questions and incoming. There are so many more. So please keep your questions nice and tight so we can get through as many as possible. We're going to bring somebody else here onto the Zoom now. And I remember this lady from yesterday with that shooting picture in the background. She's ready for us, Mr. President.
Yes, hi. My name is Gabi. I'm the chairperson of the Namibia Athletes Commission, 3 times Olympian, and my sport is obviously shooting. Firstly, I would like to thank the IOC for placing athletes at the center of the Olympic movement. As chairperson of the Namibia Athletes Commission, I feel supported and empowered with resourceful tools like the Athlete 365, as well as the annual Olympic Solidarity Grant that is available to the Athletes Commissions. The NOC in Namibia recognizes and supports our Athletes Commission with a seat and a vote on the NOC Executive Board, which really enables us to do meaningful work and effectively represent the voice of athletes. However, it is a sad reality that there are still NOCs out there who do not support Athletes Commissions in their countries, which makes it extremely difficult for athlete representatives to be effective and make a difference. I would like to know from you, Mr. President, how can the IOC ensure that all member NOCs recognize, support, and empower athlete commissions in their countries? And what sort of ultimatum can be given to NOCs who simply choose not to comply to IOC recommendations?
Oh, thank you very much. We had this discussion already at the last Athletes Forum following this and your recommendation. We had provided this subsidy of up to $10,000 per athlete commission to support them in their work, so that they can also independently from their NOC, meet and do their job. But now hearing your comment again, and this alludes a little bit to previous comment, I guess we have to look into a next step, maybe, and there to look at the Olympic Charter, and there to make a functioning NOC Athletes Commission obligatory for all the NOCs. And by doing this, this would also mean, that we could then better enforce the establishment of efficient NOC Athletes Commission. So it's already here, and I'm sure that I think Kirsty is still here. Kirsty, you want to comment? Maybe we can make another joint effort, the Athletes Commission and the Executive Board in this respect.
Thank you, President. And hi, Gabi. Thanks. Nice to see you. President, I think you said it perfectly. And
thank you.
It is. I was sitting there doing a little dance. From the athletes and the commission, and as Gabi said, even from the previous forum, this was something that came out. And we've been working with NOCs. We have seen an increase, but still not to the extent that we would like. So fully support the suggestion, Mr. President, of taking it and making it an obligation. It can only really help the NOCs, and we've seen it help so many different NOCs, just having the athletes' voice. And as well, it also helps the athletes' commissions, because then they have the opportunity to be more formal, to come up with clear roles and responsibilities that they would like to see, because that would be on them as a responsibility for the athlete commission, right? So if the NOC is then opening up that space for you to sit and to have your voice heard, then you need to ensure that you go there with a clear plan and an outline of what you would like to do. And as President mentioned, that $10,000 from Olympic Solidarity will allow you to do all of those things. So fully support that, President, and happy to take that through.
Okay, so we get a proposal from the Athletes Commission.
Yes.
Okay.
Definitely.
So.
Brilliant. Awesome. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Brilliant. Thank you so much for your question. Again, lots of them coming up for you, Mr. President. Let's see who now is beaming into the studio here. Hello, welcome.
Hello, my name is Moholo. I'm calling from Lesotho. I'm an Athletes Commission chair here in Lesotho. First of all, I would like to commend the IOC, the Athletes Commission, and the Tokyo LOC through the leadership of Mr. President to working tirelessly to keep the Olympic flame burning, even under the circumstances. My point today is based on the same issue that has been discussed by my fellow athletes, I think two of them, regarding the challenges that we face as athletes representatives in our localities. We sometimes have challenges, operational challenges and disputes. And in an event where there are disputes, we end up not knowing who and how to contact the IOC, such that we want to avoid taking our sporting family into judiciary courts we end up not knowing exactly what to do in order to make our voice heard when we feel like it's not, it's been rejected. So I think it is best that while the Atheletes Commission is going to give a proposal, it is also important for us to have a contact, the point of contact whereby we can sometimes voice our disputes and they can be heard and handled without really taking the sports issues where they are not supposed to be attended to. Thank you, Mr. President.
Well, thank you, Molo. Thank you also for your kind words. And there I think I can call on Kirsty again, because you know the Athletes Commission has appointed a number of their members as a kind of liaison persons to the continents, but also to IFs, and there this may be the most direct line that to get this kind of assistance and to get this kind of information. Kirsty?
Yes, thank you, President. Hi, Mahola. Nice to see you again. And thank you, as always, for the interventions. As President was saying, you can always reach out to us directly through Athlete 365. But I think in this instance, your first point of contact would be your Continental Association, because they would then be able to help. So that would be the ANOCA Athlete Commission. They would be able to help. They would also have direct contact again with us, and we can always step in and give some advice to you on how to walk through some of those situations that you might find yourself in. And again, through Olympic solidarity, with the funding that comes through there, through the NOCs, I know that that's sort of a lot of the issues that you were just talking on. Who do we go to when we're not getting along with our NOCs? And that came up yesterday in the topic of conversation. And I think, as we have said, reach out to us directly and we will help you from the IOC Athletes Commission. Please never feel that you can't come to us, even though it's a local problem. We are always happy to help in some way. And reach out to your continental associations, because they will have also a lot more context, and they might also be able to provide you with other sort of solutions and best practices that other athlete commissions in those regions have managed to walk through different situations like that. Thanks, Mahalo.
Thank you so much. But we all, I think as a follow-up, we also need to know at the continental level who and how to contact. Sometimes our own NOCs have the contacts that we can access. So it probably helps to say, to share them on Athletes 365 and say, this is how to reach other people in our continent. Thank you.
Thank you. That's a great question. We'll make sure we do that. And we'll make sure also take the time right now in the networking session. You can try and find, if you just type in ANOCA Athlete Commission, the different names will pop up. So take use of that networking session too.
Great stuff. I'm hoping everyone is still here with us, sending in your questions, raising your hands. In fact, give me a bit of a wave so I can see that you're all still here. You're all still paying attention. Oh, fantastic stuff. Brilliant. Okay, we have beamed someone else into the studio with us here. Mr. President, hello. What's your name and what's your question?
Hello. Hello. Hello, Mr. President. My respects. The Atlas, pleased to see you at all. My name is Olha Saladuha. I am the head of the Atlas Commission of the National Olympic Committee of Ukraine. I really want to thank you, your excellent team. It's organized committee of the Olympic Games, International Olympic Committee, of course, Commission of Athletes, and the government of Japan for the work you do to ensure that the Tokyo Olympic take place, that they are held to the high level, and the most importantly, are safe for all of us. It all motivates us very much, and we are preparing with a renewed vigor and inspiration for the main start of the season. We are well aware of how difficult it is to organize, and we are very grateful for everything. The Olympic Games are so important to all of us. I would also like to express my special gratitude for the support of the athletes. The Athlete Solidarity Program has increased the budget for the next 4 years. Thanks for the financial help for the athletes commissions. This is important for the work commissions. In our country, Sergei Bubka and I pay a lot of attention of support to the athletes. We are engaged in the development and training. And I'd like to ask the questions. What is the final stage of preparation for the Olympic Games? And I would also like to hear what actions are taking place at the moment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And again, thank you much for your encouraging words. And I know very well how much you are working in Ukraine to support your athletes together with our IOC friend Sergei Bubka, who was once the chair of the IOC Athletes Commission. So, but when it comes to what is going on the ground, why don't we call the ground then? Let's look at Tokyo. I think Pierre should be in Tokyo, so he could report firsthand what is going on right now. I can only say, you know, with the preparation of the games, the organizing committee is doing a fantastic job. We're in the delivery mode for these games. All are longing for the moment when finally the Olympic cauldron is lit. But what is happening in detail, it's much better to ask Pierre.
Pierre, right there in Tokyo, there he is. Hello, Pierre. We've got a great question for you in terms of what's happening on the ground.
Yes, thank you, President. Indeed, as you would very well know, because you work with us so closely, and especially regarding Tokyo, always telling us, you know, to remember that this is about the athletes, that we need to really make sure we focus on them to understand when we have to make decisions. So what is really happening on the ground right now? As we had the chance to discuss a little bit before, it's a lot of finalizing the venues. They are fantastic. You were able maybe to see some of them as part of the test events, but this work is really happening now. We're working very closely with the international federations, also with the NOCs, so much input that has been provided by them to give us directions when it comes to preparing the village, taking into account the elements of COVID. The playbooks are being updated, and this will come in the middle of June with the latest information so that you have everything in your hand to know what to expect from the moment you leave your home to the moment you get to Tokyo and up until the moment you leave Tokyo. On the ground here, the works is really progressing also when it comes to testing and exercising. We are running a lot of exercises at the venues, centrally, working very closely with all the stakeholders that want to prepare. Of course, the organizing committee, but also the city of Tokyo, the massive number of volunteers that they have that want to be part of these games. We also have working with us all of the Japanese government that aligns their policies to ensure that we are in the exact right place we want to be on the 23rd of July and before that when the athletes starts to arrive. So President on the ground here, lot of preparation, hardworking people. I spent the whole day in the organizing committee with them. They are so excited about being able to now count the days that separate them from these games that they have been waiting for so long. So a lot of excitement and a lot of preparation, I would say.
Okay. The name of our task force is Here We Go. So it's the same of you who are looking forward to participate in Tokyo. So let's go.
Thank you very much, Pierre. Thank you very much, Olga. I hope that answered your question. It sounds very exciting and people are really encouraged there on the ground in Tokyo. Let's head to another Zoom. Who do we have here? About to be beamed into, very dark. There we go. That's a bit better with the light. What's your name and what's your question?
Hi.
Hi.
This is Belgium calling. Hi, Lausanne. How are the walls?
We're good.
Is my connection better?
Yes, much better.
Now we can even see you.
What What's your question?
Mr. President, I would like to make an important comment and also ask a question. But I will start with the comment. We have heard many uncertainties athletes have faced also over the last few days and are still facing in the lead up to the games. But now that we are getting very close to the games, I think it's important for me, but also for the whole athlete community to acknowledge and to thank all the work and efforts which have been done to make sure the games can go on, because we all know how important these games are for us as athletes, but also we can say as the world as a whole. So I'm just really excited that the games can go on. And I'm not sure if any of our friends from Japan are on the call, but also thank you for all your efforts to make sure the games can go on. It's truly amazing. Also, with regard to safety, I think we feel very confident in Belgium that the games can be hosted safely. At the moment, more than 90% of our athletes have received their first vaccine shot. And we hope to increase it to 100 when it comes to the games. And we, of course, hope that this will also contribute to the safety of all the athletes, all of our colleagues, and also the local people in Japan. But then that brings me to my question. Yesterday, you mentioned in your introduction that we as athletes representatives, we should not only look at the past, but we should also look at the future. And my question is in line with that. My question towards you is, how do you see athletes' representation in the future, let's say in the next 5 to 10 years? Because, of course, there are always a lot of challenges coming ahead, and we as athletes have to adapt. But my question to you is, how do you see athletes' representation in the future, whether it is within an NOC or within the in an IF or the sporting movement as a whole? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I will not comment on your comment, which I appreciate. Take this as an example, learning there from the efforts about vaccination. The more of you and all of us are vaccinated, the better for everybody. With regard to athletes' representation, now, what I would love to is that in the shortest possible period, we would not need to talk anymore about it, that it becomes a normal, that we get there all the NOCs and IFs to accept and implement the athletes' rights and responsibilities declaration. That we have in all NOCs, then athletes' commissions, to what we have been referring to before, and also in all IFs, so that the athletes' representation becomes a part of the overall organization of sports, and that this goes then without saying, and that then everybody can experience the benefits of a solid athletes representation and of a legitimized athletes representation like we do in the Olympic movement, with the elections of the athletes commission members and with all the positive consequences this has for their power within the IOC and the Olympic movement. I think this is what we need to working for. But my vision would be that my successor then in a couple of years does not need to answer the question anymore.
Does that help? Fantastic. Good. I'm glad that a lot of you are asking about the future, I guess, because there are so many lessons that can be learned to pass on to the next generation of athletes that go to Olympic Games and are part of the Olympic movement. And let's head to the Zoom
now. And who do we have here in our studio?
Hi, good morning from Suriname. Good day, President Bach. I'm Kirti Algo from the Atheletes Commission of Suriname. I'm the chair, and it's such a great opportunity to have this floor with you. I have a very simple question. Yesterday, we paid lots of attention.
These are the most difficult ones, usually. If people start like this, then it becomes tricky.
No. Actually, I really admire your organization's effort to address our needs and especially our complexities, because that's what I'm trying to raising up today. You see, yesterday we talked about the resilience of athletes. And when we talk about resilience of athletes, it comes back to infrastructure, available resources, which is a greater challenge for the smaller nations like ours in the Caribbean. And we started as an athlete commission in 2019. And I must say that since then, we have been working closely with the IOC athlete commission. And we have gratefully used the resources, such as the grants for the athlete commissions. But here is my huge problem. We don't have counselors for our athletes. We hardly have sports psychologists. And during this pandemic, it's a real issue for our athletes to move on with sports. It's not only the athletes, but also the coaches. Whenever we organize Zoom sessions for mental health for our athletes, we find that we also have to include our coaches to make it work. So we came with this idea to organize a course with the university, training sports psychologists. You see, so we are thinking about creating an infrastructure in a society where everything is complete chaos politically, economically, and we really rely on the resources and the support of the IOC. So what we did as an EC, we sent a specific email to the IOC, the 365 Athletes Commission. And what happened is they said, unfortunately, they cannot help me. They have to limit themselves to the $10,000 US dollars, which I understand. But is there some possibility that we can apply for specific projects? Can the IOC take a particular look at our needs? You know, the smaller nations, they struggle with the really basic resources. And it's such a pity to see our athletes, our coaches struggle with the essential things in sports. And we as an athlete commission, we just have to take a look at it and say, okay, let's see what we can do. So that's my simple question.
My feeling was correct. Huh? That whenever somebody starts, I have a very simple question, it becomes complicated. But you know, there I would then like to refer to Dr. Budget right after, that maybe he can explain, you know, from our medical and scientific commission what the programs are being undertaken, and then maybe also James McLeod, you know, to explain a little bit what and how far solidarity, Olympic solidarity can go. I don't know whether, you know, this will fit to the education of sport psychologists in Suriname, but maybe they are creative and find their projects for which then your NOC and you, together with your NOC, can then apply for. So, Richard, would you?
We've got Dr. Budget just here on the right hand side. Hello, Dr. Budget.
Hello, good to see you again. Hi,
Richard.
Did you get Curtis's question?
I did.
Okay, fantastic.
Yes. Very good question as well. Good to see you again, Kirsty. I mean, as we touched on yesterday. Clearly, the IOC have a lot of resources that the smaller nations can use. I mean, for starters, there's Athlete 365, which you mentioned, but there's also diagnostic tools, which our expert group, the expert working group on mental health, have put together. And then there's a certificate in mental health, and there's a diploma in mental health. So I think the key thing is to upskill and help all those who are working with your athletes, so they really understand the issues of mental health, know who to refer to, how to deal with things if that's within their capacity. But I agree there is a capacity issue at the moment. And as was mentioned yesterday, it would be great if every athlete had a psychologist the same way as they have a dentist. But hopefully they'd be even keener to see the psychologist than they would the dentist. I think if we can get those trained professionals, particularly the few that can deal with the really difficult problems, then that'll be fantastic. And I think, President, if I could refer on to James for a description of the support that, as you mentioned, Olympic Solidarity can give to accessing those educational tools, that might be very relevant as well.
Okay, here comes James, if I see you. Yeah, it's him.
Thank you, Richard, and nice to see you all again. I'm just referring to the workshops on mental health. I know it's something that came up quite a lot yesterday in the specific session that we had on mental health. And it's certainly something we need to take forward, especially the education to the athlete commissions and making sure that they have all the information that they need so that athletes can go directly to support from us rather than going through intermediaries, whether it's the NOCs, et cetera. And that's something that Kirsty and the team are looking at. If I can, just on the general support that is available, as a reminder, Olympic Solidarity is there to help the NOCs with the greatest need, and in particular athletes, and you can actually refer to the Olympic Charter for that. And all of our programs are looking at all the different levels of development, whether it's athletes, it's coaches, it's sports administrators, etc. And we'd invite you to go to athlete365 or olympics.com, where you'll be able to get a list of all of those programs. And really what we try to do is cover every level of development in every country. And obviously you need to apply through your National Olympic Committee for that assistance. But we do hope that it covers all of the areas that you were referring to.
Thank you. Kirti, I really hope that helps. James, thank you. Dr. Budget, thank you. Mr. President, isn't it great that you've got these fantastic directors? You can just call upon them and they're ready to go every time.
No. If I'm praising them now too much, you know, they may even believe it. So, okay. And they know that they are doing a great job. But no need to tell them every day.
Okay, fine. Just keep them there. All right.
And anyway, we will have a cocktail together this evening, so there will still be an opportunity.
Brilliant stuff. Okay, let's head to the Zoom and find out who we have to take to the floor and ask your question. Who do we have here? Just over here.
Hi, Mr. Bach. My name is Jonathan Gurr, and I'm from the Russian Olympic Committee, Athletes Committee. And first of all, I'd like to say that I had the privilege of being a volunteer 2 years ago when you had the last forum. And it was an amazing experience. And what's even more amazing is to see how far everybody's come. The Athlete 365 platform just keeps increasing, so much more material, so much that we as athletes can actually grow from, which is very important. And also, I'd like to thank you for this unique opportunity in such a difficult time when it's important to be stronger together. And as the Olympic family, now we need each other more than ever. And I'd also like to thank you and the team for what you've done for the preparation for the Tokyo Olympics, which is going to be soon. And first and foremost, it's the health of the athletes that you've put as your main priority, which we respect and completely enjoy. So we, as the Russian Athletes Committee, can say that a lot of our athletes have already been vaccinated, and the majority of them before Tokyo plan to be fully vaccinated. That's something that has been put as our main pillar coming up to these games. And it's something that we find that's very important for our own safety, the safety of our entourage, and obviously at the games. And hopefully that everybody, I understand everybody's at different places with the pandemic, but hopefully everybody can come together and do what's best in the interests of making the games happen. And with saying all of that, we have a lot of hope that when we get to the games, the host country will be able to take into account all of the efforts that we've put to make that all happen. And if heaven forbid, any difficult or spicy situations happen, everything will be done in the best interest of the athletes.
I think there you can rest assured. You know, our experience there in working with the organizing committee now for 8 years, you know, is really an excellent one. What we have said there all the time is that Tokyo is the best prepared Olympic city ever. And this relates in particular to the focus they are putting on the athletes and the athletes' experience. Because of the pandemic, we all know, unfortunately, the athletes' experience, you discussed it before, you know, will be very, very different. But what is important is that, you know, the competitions, and these are the essentials, can and will take place in a safe way and in full respect thereof the athletes. And, you know, you have, you may have seen her before, you know, as the president of the organizing committee, a 7-time Olympian. So this should give all of us, you know, a lot of confidence that it's really about the athletes, and that it's about to making the athletes feel comfortable and to making the Japanese people feeling comfortable with the participants of the games. And there again, this high vaccination rate is an important factor on top of all the measures and restrictions we will respect as we have them in the playbooks. So come with full confidence to Tokyo and get ready.
Brilliant. Thank you. Very exciting. Only 57 days away from the start of those games. And remember, as you take to the floor here and ask your questions, please keep them nice and tight so we can get through as many as possible. I'm so conscious of the time. So who do we have here in the studio now? Hi. Hello, I think you're on mute. We can't hear you.
I try to, okay.
Brilliant.
Dear President, it's great to see you here, and dear fellow athletes.
Good to see you again.
Yeah, I'm a Yang, short track speed skater from China, and the chairperson of Athletic Committee of Beijing 2022 Winter Olympic Games Organizing Committee. And it's a great pleasure to see everyone online, and thanks to IOC Athletic Committee for organizing such important forum. And also congratulations to Athletic Committee for what you have done for athletes. And Kirsty, great job. And I would like to use this opportunity to raise the awareness of the recent years, the political intervention to sports, and especially damage the rights of the athletes to participate in the Olympics. As president, you already raised the awareness, and Also, as you said, it's very important that we should be together, and the Olympic is a very unique platform for athletes from the world to be together, to pursue their dreams, and also to inspire the peoples. So therefore, I would like to propose that we should protect the clean and the qualified athletes, protect their rights to participate in the Olympics. And I'm not sure it's possible to put in the Olympic Charter or athlete declaration, just to protect their rights. And that's my proposal. And also I would like to introduce a little bit about Beijing 2022 Winter Olympics. Before I introduce, I would like to send my best wishes to Tokyo Olympics, and good luck to all the athletes for Tokyo. And Beijing, we are ready to host the games. And I and my fellow athletes, the members of the athlete committee, is working very hard, also working very closely with the Bocock, and make sure the games is going to be athlete-centered games. So we cannot wait to welcome you, Mr. President. Also, we cannot wait to welcome the athlete from the world. Okay, that's my words for today. And it's great to see everyone here.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Yang. Great to see you. And again, Yang, you know, is very humble because she did not mention that she also has a very important position in the fight against doping and to protect the clean athletes. This is as a vice president of WADA. So you can rely on her. They're defending the athletes' rights there in the World Anti-Doping Organization. With regards to you know, the politicization of the Olympic Games and boycotts, the position of the IOC and the Olympic movement is very clear. You know, our mission enshrined in the Olympic Charter is to unite the world and to be the event and the only event in the which brings the entire world together in a peaceful competition. And we can accomplish this mission only if we are always building bridges. If we are erecting walls, then we become divisive. And politics, as you know, is divisive. There are always different point of views. And if one wants to impose his or her point of view on others and vice versa, this becomes very divisive and we could never accomplish the mission. And this means, and there I'm coming to your proposal with regard to Olympic Charter, that we have to be politically neutral. In the Olympic Games, there can be no discrimination for whatever reason, whether it's religious, whether it's political, whether it's sexual orientation. There in the Games, we all need to be equal and we all need to respect each other. And we need not only to respect the diversity, we need to embrace the diversity. We need to be happy that it's possible to come together, even if you have a very different culture, even if you have a very different political opinion, that we can come together and that we can agree on the Olympic values. And that this is what we are standing for, beyond all the differences we may have. Therefore, you know, we have in the Olympic Charter enshrined not only these values, we have also enshrined the political neutrality of the IOC and the Olympic Games. And in order to protect the National Olympic Committees from political pressure in their countries, which may arise. And myself, I had to make this experience at the time when you know, we had to boycott Olympic Games there in 1980. And as a consequence, we put then later into the Olympic Charter the obligation for National Olympic Committees to take part in the Games of the Olympiad. You cannot make it for the Winter Games because not every country can you know, offer winter sports, but it shows the overall philosophy and obligation. On the one hand, political neutrality has to be respected by all the components of the Olympic movement. And on the other hand, not only the right to take part in the Games, but the obligation to take part in the Olympic Games, and in this way to contribute to this unifying mission, to this unifying power of the Olympic Games. And I think this is what we now, in this divisive, in this aggressively divisive world that we are living in at this moment, this is something what is maybe more needed than ever, and what also the world is really looking for, to have, you know, at least this one area of sport, and in particular Olympic Games, where we can still come together, where we are sharing the same values, and where we show that we can coexist in friendship while having maybe the toughest competition of our life.
Thank you, President.
Brilliant stuff. That's a great question. Fantastic question. Thank you so much for your time. Okay, we're moving on. We're pushing through. We're heading. I think I recognize this face. Hello. Welcome to the floor.
Hello, once again. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. And to President Bach, hello. My name is David Hart, a Rio 2016 field hockey Olympian, proudly representing here today the Olympic Federation of Ireland and the European Olympic Committee's Athletes Commission, and a current candidate to the IOC Athletes Commission in Tokyo. I would like to reiterate what I said yesterday, complimenting the IOC and, of course, the IOC Athletes Commission for making this forum possible. It has been fantastic to do so in the digital world that we live in today. I do have one question, but let me first, of course, state that competing athletes, as well as their entourage, are the most important individuals right now. But regarding the IOC Athletes Commission elections, and given the nature of how important the Athletes Commission have been in this last year in particular, and to obviously continue to promote all athletes around the world and their voice. In Tokyo, how do you foresee the landscape and environment on the ground in Tokyo for the candidates when meeting and greeting will no longer be possible?
You're asking for advice for your campaign. I don't know, you know, whether I can really be allowed to give advice. Your competitors may complain. But I think, seriously speaking, don't worry. there, the athletes commission again. You know, they are working on this, on how the voting can take place and how you can campaign, how you can, you know, make your points and try to convince as many as your fellow athletes as possible to vote for you. Kirsty?
Thank you, President. And thanks. Hi again. Thank you for the question. So obviously, as we are doing right now, everything has moved more digital. So you are all allowed to promote yourselves digitally as much as you can. And those of you that are going to be at the games and in the village, you'll be able to go. And within the restricted areas, as always, there's specific areas where we're not allowed to engage with athletes, but there's other areas where you can totally have good conversations with athletes, obviously sticking to all the protocols that are being followed. But you will have plenty of time and plenty of opportunity to engage with fellow athletes during the games. And again, through all the digital means possible, that we know we've opened that up, and we know that this is a different time, but that is all there for all of you to do at the same and all on the same level. Hope that was clear enough.
So, good luck.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much. It's all these challenges that are going to be presented. So it's good that Kirsty can come on and really give you an overview of some of that detail. And we can see somebody here now in the Zoom. Hope your microphone's on. I hope your question's nice and tight. Who's that and where are you calling in from?
Good morning, good evening, and good afternoon. Thank you, President Bach, for meeting with us athletes and taking our questions. I will jump to my question, but I will preface, I'm Mark Ladwig of the United States. I'm on our athlete committee. We have several members of our leadership group, and I'm just one of the many that's able to give back through initiatives like you've mentioned at the various countries and how you're supporting athlete commissions. And I've been able to be involved for over probably about 15 years now in our sports organization. And I go all the way back to being a volunteer in 2002 in Salt Lake City. And I remember the challenges after 9/11 being a volunteer at a games. And I applaud you for all your efforts moving forward. But I will pivot to one of the questions that many of our members are asking, and that's about waivers that are potentially to be asked of the athletes regarding, you know, whether it's heat or COVID or exposure. As an Olympian in 2010, I don't remember having to sign any of things like that. And so I'd like your expound on those things that might be asked of athletes at this games.
Oh, thank you for this question. I know that this is of concern for a number of you, and this is why I would prefer you get an expert's answer rather than me trying to explain all of this. So may I call on our CEO Lana Haddad, maybe to explain the framework of all of this and how it happened in the past and how it's happening now. Okay, if you agree, thank you. Lana?
Lana's just here.
Thank you, President.
This side, yes.
Thank you, President, and thank you, Mark, for the question. If I may, as you must have followed the news all around the world on COVID-19, no government, no health authority can or has taken over guarantees against infections. This is a risk that we all bear. This is one of the points. The second, the entry forms have been actually in place for previous games and have been updated to include COVID-19 related consideration. This really to provide transparency and ensures informed consent from the games participants. In this session alone, a number of you really appreciated the transparency element of this, and that's why we actually live in everything we do. We do a transparency, so this is for transparency and ensure informed consent. In addition, the entry forms are consistent with the standard practice of all other big event organizers. And the forms are within the framework of the law, if I may add. In general, as you also have heard on the COVID-19 countermeasures, the playbook, all, whether they are vaccinated or not, have to follow the same rules. So we are all following the same playbook, the same countermeasures. And hopefully with this explanation, it clarifies some of the elements that you asked.
How was that for you?
I would love to see what's included in that form, but just on behalf of my athletes. But I understand that, and that goes along with the transparency that you mentioned earlier about audit.
But the entry form is public.
Yes, indeed.
Entry form is public. It's even in the regulations, and it's therefore. Even I, when I was participating in the games just a couple of years ago, I remember that I had to sign the entry form. So,
and your NOC has it. So if you can refer to them, they will give it to you, I'm sure. And we will also make it available to you. There's no issue.
No problem. If I may real quickly ask, that you mentioned earlier about audits of NOCs. I looked quickly on the IOC site, but I did not see those reports as public. Is that something you will share with athlete commissions? I'm sorry, that's not specific to the entry forms, but it was more to President Bach, if that's something as an initiative, maybe to connect with your athlete groups.
No, this is between Olympic solidarity and the use of their funds and the NOCs. There already, if you know, for legal reasons, you would have to turn to your NOC then to get access of this kind of audits. And there, mentioning it, there we will also do another step with regard to the scope of the audits. This will in the future also turn to a more governance questions rather than the mere financial questions, which were in the focus so far. But there, you would need to turn to your national, to your OPC in your case.
Understood. And thank you for your time. And I appreciate that you've come before all the athletes. I know you're taking it on the chin to see us all.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, lots more of you trying to come in along into the studio as we wait for the next person to come up on Zoom. They're going to beam right in. And hello, welcome to the studio.
Hello, how are you? Dear President Bach, it's an honor to be here with you and can speak directly to you also. I'm Gabriel Sagastume from the Guatemalan Athlete Commission Chair. And my question or advice that I'm talking to you is related with the career transition. You know, Tokyo is the last stop for many athletes in their career, in sports career. So I have the honor also to work with the IOC delivering workshops in America. Actually, today we will have one here in Guatemala with my good friend Carlos Santiago from the Pan Am Sports Athlete Commission. And what advice you can give also to the Athlete Commission, to the NOCs and entourage with the athletes, so we can support and strengthen this topic with the athletes that will make this transition from the sports and from their sports to the professional or other areas. Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Oh, thank you. And then give best regards to Carlos when you happen to see him later this day. You know, with regard to a career transition, we are offering quite a range of different projects and programs. I think I saw there in one of the sessions this afternoon there about the business accelerator. Yeah. For instance, this great program we are doing there with Mohamed Yunus and his foundation, of which already I think about 5,000 athletes, if I'm well informed, have benefited from. There are other initiatives with you know, workshops, as you're mentioning, and the Athletes 365 programs, and also encouraging then the National Olympic Committees to do their job on the ground. Because in the end, you know, you have to find employment then on the local level, on the national level, and there is no one size fits all program, and there the interests are so different. But what you know, we are also doing there is working closely with our top sponsors, and there you see, for instance, Intel, you know, offering employment programs for Olympians in particular. You see other of these top sponsors offering such opportunities, and if you ask me, they are doing more themselves a favor than the athletes. Because all the experience shows that you know, once an athlete is changing into the professional life, they are doing so with the same ambition, with the same determination, and with the same team spirit as they have approached their sports career. And they are in a short term, you know, one of the assets than in the different companies. And this consciousness and this experience, I think more and more worldwide companies are learning about. And then this is at least the experience we also get from Adecco, with whom we are working, and who are working then on the national level, that for them it becomes easier now to approach companies and to make them the offer to hire athletes and Olympians. So it's a wide range, and I can only advise, you know, benefit from it as much as possible, And there again, if you need further information, have a look at Athlete 365 or contact then the Athletes Commission directly. Have I delivered everything, Kirsty? Or
yes, yes.
Okay, I'm speaking under supervision here, so.
Hopefully that answered your question, and good luck with your meeting as well. Well done for getting in a good question ahead of that meeting. Well done. And it is true, Athlete 365, so many resources for all of you. You know where to go. The platform has everything for you there, especially for career transition. And let's move on to another guest here that's come to our Zoom studio. Hello? I'm not sure she realizes that she's in with us.
Can you see us?
Yeah.
Hi.
Yeah. Hello, what's your question?
Hi. Sorry, I was on mute and I couldn't fix it that quickly. Can you
all
hear
fine.
Me?
Yes, we hear and see you and wait for you.
Mr. President Bach, Tabir Aysawi from Egypt, board member at the WOA. I cannot express how thrilled today to speak directly with you, and I will give one appreciation and say one suggestion. First, I want to be appreciative that today I see that an Arabic language channel has been added to the Athletes Forum today, especially that I had the honor in 2019, I represented the Egyptian athletes at the Athletes Forum. And this is something new, and that also so the Athletes 365 workshop Career Plus was giving for the first time ever in Arabic a few months ago, specifically to the Arab-speaking countries. So I wanted to really appreciate and endorse this incredible step, and I believe bringing more opportunities and making this accessible, and hopefully all the resources over the 365 Athletes platform would be accessible also to Arabic-speaking language and other athletes all over the world. So I just want to recognize and appreciate this. Second thing is that I know that you and everyone knows how crucial is investing in Africa and in the Middle East, not only for how important it is for the region, but also how important it is for the global development. As I have big dreams to my region, today I will only focus on one suggestion, giving the first that my first appreciation speech, which is considering or adding the Arabic official coverage for the Olympic Games, especially that I know a great statistics that people are eager to listen and see those stories in sport, news and stories. And I believe the IOC want to really take advantage of this, especially this will reach a whole region of 500 million people. And it's crucial given the global development as sports would positively impact not only the whole region, but the whole world. And it's become crucial, not only because I come from this region or represent the region, but it's a good investing in reaching out a huge number of people, and how is it's essential and beneficial globally to the development, and how this will impact, especially that my region is a young population and one of the fastest growing over the world. So sports can easily impact the whole world by producing effective and healthy individuals, and will help us to avoid or prevent us from unneeded burden. Thank you so much for listening to me.
Thank you very much. With regard to the appreciation for the language here in the forum, I think Kirsty and Danka, I know Danka is in competition today, So we will convey it there also to her. And with regard to the other question, did I understand correctly that you were referring to the Olympic Channel?
Yes. And the coverage of the Olympic Games news and results up to date, there's a lot of Arabic coverage in my region, but my suggestion is IOC itself and the Olympic Games to take advantage of this and be the official resource for the news in Arabic, because I know the statistic that says people are really watching this and really it's really impacting my region in development, and also it could be a good investment and revenue for the IEC too.
There I would need to ask whether Yanis is there somewhere in the loop. He is, you know, the chair of our production system, the Olympic production system, the broadcasting system for the games. But in general, I will talk until we find out whether he's here or
Yanis,
there.
Yanis isn't over.
But sure. You know, in general, this is a challenge because the broadcasting rights are going to the different countries and territories, and there then. They are responsible then also, you know, for the news and the overall coverage. And I guess that in Egypt they do it in Arabic and BeIN, which is you know one of our the partner, not the one, it's the partner there in the region, is of course offering there the Olympic program in Arabic. So. Do we have?
We don't have Yanis, I'm afraid. No.
We don't have Yanis, so I need to keep talking, or I promise that we are coming back to you, then with maybe a more expert answer than the one I tried to give to you at this moment.
Thank you, Mr. Bach. Thank you, President.
Okay, and good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Okay, we are down to our last lucky Zoomer who's going to be beamed into our studio here in Lausanne to speak to us here. And hello.
Hi, I'm Kimberly Rohde, and I represent the Athlete Committee of the ISSF. And I have competed in the last 6 Olympics and have 6 medals. I know Bach was there at my last Olympics cheering me on in the stands. So this question is for you, Bach. National federations vote in the leadership of ISSF, and the athletes vote in the athlete representatives. And in this case, the relationship is always politically related to the national federations. They will not listen to the athletes because the athletes don't vote them in. The leadership are only worried about the next election. Our athlete committee is currently only one vote on the executive committee board. No matter which direction our athlete committee goes to better represent our athletes, the leadership always have majority to go in the direction that they decide. How can athletes committees have more power or votes inside the executive committees to better represent the athletes in our sports? Does IOC have a formal way, or have they given any thought to this to help us increase those athletes' votes, to have a higher percentage of athletes voting in the executive committees of international federations?
Oh, thank you. You know, I could give you the formal answer that this is the responsibility of the international federations. But you know the attitude we are taking in the IOC. And, you know, this is having you electing your representatives, having them in every commission with a representative and having them also in the executive board. Now you can always argue about, you know, how many votes here and there in the IOC executive board. It's also it's one vote, yes, but we are also only, you know, 15. But I think we never had a vote, at least I would not remember, that we never had a vote against a recommendation coming from the athletes' commission. You know, in order there to drive things forward, you also need to have a spirit of cooperation, the readiness of all the others. You can also not expect, let me put it, you know, this way, that whatever the athlete representative is putting forward, that this is the only truth. There are also sometimes other considerations to be taken, and this has to be solved then in a spirit of cooperation. This is what we are trying to do and what we are doing in the IOC, where again, Kirsty, did I miss one decision which was taken against the Athletes Commission? At least I would not remember, but you can contradict me, right after. And in this way, we want to also in this, to lead by example, and to convince the international federations and also the national Olympic committees that in fact it's a great benefit. It's a great benefit to have there the athletes' opinion immediately being represented, to have the athletes' voice heard, because otherwise, on the long term, you will not be able to develop your sport if it is not supported by the athletes. Kirsty?
Yeah, thank you, President. Hi, Kimberly, and congratulations again for all those gold medals. You failed to leave out the gold, but no, President, you're 100% right. We have never taken anything to the executive board that has been turned down. And I think that is not only because they're really good recommendations and because we've been very clear in our processes and we've had a lot of interaction with athlete commissions that make our recommendations stronger, but it's because of the relationship that we have with the executive board. As a commission, we've really, over the last few years, built a very good relationship and communication with the executive board. So they always know what we're doing, and we try to give them probably way more information than they even want on all of the things that we're doing. So that is really key, that you're not just one person, you're an entire commission, and you've got to be really good at the communication that you have with your entire executive board. And I know that I've found that to be super helpful, and the commission has been very supportive of doing that as well, and having that support by the president and the entire executive board.
Well, I mean, we appreciate your answer, but I mean, as we look as an athlete committee, I mean, we work very closely with the executive board and also with a lot of the athletes, but as we push forward to try to implement things and work with the executive board, we all always are faced with an uphill battle of trying to convince and also, just get the different things put through. And of course, obviously the athlete committee recognizes that we don't want 100% of everything. We understand that it's a give and a take in every situation, but at the same time, it is something that we definitely face in the shooting sports as far as trying to get our voices heard and trying to get things put through that are beneficial to the athletes and for the future of our sport. And I think a great example of that is the Paris 2024 proposal that they just put forward, which thankfully IOC, I believe, rejected and is now gone back to us, and we're trying to work through that. But there are challenges faced, and having more votes on that board would definitely help the athletes achieve at least some goal, at least have some backing there, because right now we are only one vote, and that is definitely a challenge, especially when we don't even get to vote in our leadership.
Yeah, I think that's fully understood. And I think that's something that we can definitely look at. And that probably is a very big difference, because we do get a vote in our leadership. We get 15 votes actually at the IOC session that we get to vote for who we want to lead the organization. So that is definitely something that I'll take back to the team, and I'm sure that we can discuss and definitely try to help support the federations and NOCs to ensure that their athletes are voting members of the executive board and not just having a seat there.
Right. It's just a balance would be nice.
Do I understand you correctly, you know, that you have a seat in the executive board, but you do not have votes in the General Assembly?
That is correct.
Okay. Now then, let's have a look into this, because, you know, as Kirsty very explained, this is very different from our concept of an athletes commission.
So whatever the national federation's okay. voting in.
Why don't you get, you know, this appears to be a pretty bilateral thing there now between a shooting federation and athletes commission. Why don't you get in contact?
Will do.
Because again, you know, this concept is very different from our concept, how we want to see athletes commissions functioning.
Will do. I'll be in touch.
Okay. Thank you.
I know I said that was the last question, but I've been instructed. This is what happens when you're the big boss and you want more questions. So there is more time for a last question for sure now. Let's see who we've got beaming into the studio now. You've won the lottery. Hello.
Hello. You're on mute.
Let's get your sound up. Turn your microphone on for us so we can
okay,
hear you.
Okay. Oh, yes. Donc, je vous dis bonjour ou bon après-midi.
I will say hello to you, wherever you are. I'm Patrick Ndaysenga. I'm Treasurer of the Athletes Commission of Burundi. Mr. President, my first question is the following. First question.
Tous les continents africains ont déjà organisé.
All continents have already had the Olympic Games, except for Africa. So, what are you going to do to help Africa, push Africa to organize the games, the Olympic Games? That's my first question. Second question for you, Mr. President. There are often problems between the NOCs and the governments of their country, especially in Africa, where the NOCs do not get any financial support for their operations and activities. Very often, the Minister of Sport will not grant the NOC any financial support. So, question. Couldn't we see the financial statements of the NOCs, and couldn't they submit them to the sports minister so that there's more transparency and to make sure that there is no mismanagement whatsoever? Thank you for your attention. Thank you, Patrick. Well, with this last question, you are touching upon a very delicate and emotional question. It's always been my dream that during my presidency, we'd see Olympic Games hosted in Africa, or at least the plan B, to be able to award the games to an African country. But unfortunately, we have not been able to achieve this dream of mine because we've never had any candidates bidding for the games during my presidency. When I realized that this was the case, I suggested that the Youth Olympic Games be awarded to an African country without any competition. We just make sure that the Youth Olympic Games would be reserved to one of the African countries, and we were able to do so. We were able to award these Youth Olympic Games to Senegal, to Dakar, and the year chosen was 2022, but because of the pandemic and because of the challenges arising from this pandemic, we had to postpone the holding of the Games in agreement with Senegal to 2026. So there will be these Games will be taking place in 2026. As former president of the IOC, I will attend these Games.
This call for transparency, I explained that the annual reports of the budgets of the National Olympic Committees, they are audited at least once during the Olympiad by the NOC, but it's also part of the minimum requirements for good governance, which are applicable to all NOCs, that they are producing annually these audited reports. And they must be open there to all the members of the NOCs and to all the leadership. And if that would not be the case then we would find out during these audits, or anybody who sees something like this happening in their NOC, they can turn to us, and then we will contact the NOC and ensure the production of this kind of audited reports in compliance with the rules of good governance. Okay, one more, or what?
So much, and everybody is.
I see them already. Some of them are already stretching, so they're getting tired.
Give me a final wave, everyone, so I know you're all there with me still. Look at them. Yes, that is real stamina. True Olympic community there. Thank you so much, Mr. President. As always, it was great to share a stage. I just sat down the whole time. I've had an absolutely great time, but. For you, I guess my final question is, being able to come here today and see this done in a digital way, it being virtual, how important is it that you're able to reach the athlete community like this?
It's extremely important, but it's not the ultimate experience. I would rather prefer to see all of you in one place and being together and being able to hug each other and to shake hands. Or to greet each other rather than just having to do elbow bumps. This, for me, is not the ultimate human experience. But since we are all missing this contact and have to miss it, it's even more important that we have this opportunity at least to communicate remotely, to keep each other informed and, for us, getting your input. And this is why it was, again, a pleasure. But I hope then, for the ultimate pleasure at the next Athletes Forum, then to see as many as possible of you in person and then have the dynamics of a personal meeting being enjoyed by all of us together. But thank you, you know, for all your engagement, for your participation, for all the drive you are giving us every day, because this is what we are here for. And again, you know, the name of our task force is here we go. So here we go, vamos.
Thank you very, very much. And they're giving you a virtual round of applause.
Okay, I can so see bye-bye.
Take care. Thank you so, so much bye-bye. To the community. And thank you, Mr. President, for your time here today. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeanette. Thank you. Bye.
I've just had to usher off our IOC president in the nicest possible way. Time I did this 2 years ago, it was very different to what it is today. And like Mr. President said, hopefully in 2 years' time, I get to see some of you in person and with the human element and response that we absolutely love. I'm going to pass over to Kirsty Coventry to bring the forum to a complete close. I'm wishing everybody that will be in Tokyo the best of luck, and I will see you there. Thank you very much for your time.
Here we guys, what an amazing 2 days this first ever virtual athletes forum has been. And I wanna just take a few minutes to bring up the team that's behind the scene that you guys can't see, because there's an incredibly big team behind this production and they deserve a big round of applause. So even maybe turn your microphones on, let them hear your clap. If I can ask the team to come up, we're gonna observe protocols. I'm gonna stand in the corner and everyone's gonna give a wave as they come through and say hi. But just thank you to the team. We wouldn't be here without them. So there's lots of clapping on the screen and thank you guys. Thank you. Virtual high five. And to the entire production team that is still doing their work, still continuing, thank you so much for everything. For the next forum in 2023, I hope that we will all be in Lausanne. I won't be here. The next chair of the IOC Athlete Commission will be here. Guys, thank you so much. It has been a year like no other for all of us, with plenty of challenges, but with also of plenty of innovation and creativity, finding new ways to connect, new ways to collaborate, and new ways to make the network of Athlete Commission stronger together. Thank you so much to all of you for taking the time to ensure that your voice is heard. Please stay safe, stay strong, and hope to see you all soon. Goodbye, everyone.